Welcome to Brawlhalla. Hodvar. Cassidy. Orion. Lord Brax. Nav. Queen Kai. Hattori.
All right, welcome to the number 3 Brawlhalla Mini-Tournament. Let me get my camera up and set up and ready to go. So, hi, I'm Compton EMT. I am your host. It does look like my microphone on Twitch is not working properly. So let me go ahead and get that set up before we do anything at all. Huh, it doesn't seem to be working. So let me go ahead and stop streaming on Twitch real quick. Close it down. And we'll go ahead and open it up again, just to get it all going. So yeah, never do you have a tournament where there's not an issue. So, let's see, let's make sure that we're on the right sync and profile, and we are. Let's go ahead and start streaming. Yes, there we go, we have it now. We have the audio. So let's go ahead and play a little bit of music. With me today, I do have Raidhyn. So Raidhyn, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good, man. Good to be on stream.
Yeah, definitely. I'm happy to have you. I know you have won the last two mini tournaments, the first two mini tournaments that we had. You did say you were going to sit out this one just to kind of see who would kind of, you know, bring themselves up out of this group of players so you could train with them.
Yeah, I'm kind of interested to see what happens when I'm not a factor, because I feel like some of the best players are ones that I've knocked out in the past, so I'm really interested to see how they're going to do when I'm not there interfering with the bracket, so to speak.
Yeah, and definitely I think some players might have felt that, specifically Misfit last time, since, you know, in those earlier rounds for these mini tournaments, we do go with that one and done scenario just to kind of get things sped up. So as far as the group of players that you're seeing today, what do you think of these players that are coming out?
Well, what's interesting about it is that we do have a pretty new mix of people compared to the last tournament. We've got some new faces, got some old faces, people who have been playing for a very long time, people who have just come in the last couple of weeks. We've got more people who have kind of showed up from more of a Smash Brothers background who have come and embraced Brawlhalla. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how it all plays out. I'm also interested in seeing just how far some people who didn't make it as deep in the last tournament, how much they've improved or if their playstyles have changed, and they're just kind of seeing how the competitive meta has evolved since 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, definitely. And one of the things we have to note is the new patch that came out this week. That patch had some network fixes. I mean, how much better has the game been since those have come into play?
For me, it's made a huge difference. During the 1.4 patch, I was having terrible lag problems, and just felt like the game had been broken for me, and I barely played at all during the 1.4 patch. But as soon as 1.5 hit, all of the worries that I had kind of went away, and everything was good to go. So,
yeah. So we have done our check-ins. We did grab a couple of players from the stream that actually did a giveaway. None of them actually needed keys, but we do have a good list of players. So our people that won the giveaway were Icy Cow, Weird Jacob, Magma Bomb, and Disfireco. Disfireco actually having some computer problems, so then we went with Ninja Fans after that. He was the fifth person there. So yeah, those are our extra players for our actual free-for-all games. Game A, and actually we did previous seeding for these, for the players that did sign up, and then we kind of did a snaking. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, that's kind of what a snaking bracket is. So in our first round, in Game A, we're going to have Misfit, Annx, and Icy Cow playing. Then we're going to have in Game B, Kreutz, Xeno, Weird Jacob. Game C is going to be Binks, Fearless, and Magma Bomb. And then Game D is going to be Hamaya, Dyne, and Ninja Fans. So, I mean, who do you think is going to be coming in that top game in that second round?
And we're talking free-for-all matches.
Right? Yeah, we're talking free-for-all here. It's a three-person free-for-all since we do have 12 total players in this tournament.
You know, free-for-all for me, it's always a toss-up, because sometimes people who are used to 1v1 matches don't do so well in free-for-all situations, so they have more that they have to pay attention to. And as I've said in the past, some of the tactics that you use in free-for-all, like using heavy attacks and kind of waiting for other players to set up the bad guys for you, don't really apply in 1v1. So for me, free-for-all makes for a great warm-up, but it's kind of hard for me to say.
Yeah, definitely. So it does look like it is noon. We are going to set those games off. Just sent in the Brawlhalla competitive community chat that they should get their start right now. So those games, they'll take about 4 minutes. Our rules for those are the standard online matchmaking rules. So 4 minutes by points. Whoever has the most points at the end moves on to our top game. The second place person in each of those games moves on to our mid game, and the third place person from each of those games moves on to our bottom game. So yeah, that's how it's going. The game should be getting ready to go and getting started. So in about 5 to 7 minutes, we will have our matchups for that round two. None of these games will be streamed. We're playing them concurrently just for time's sake. But after that second round, free-for-all, we will have our brackets. That first round is going to be played. That wild card round is also going to be played off stream. But then going from the quarterfinals, semifinals, and finals, we'll have every single game streamed for you. So yeah, as far as the game goes, Raidhyn, I mean, the other stuff in the last couple of patches since our last tournament, you want to fill us in on some of that stuff?
Well, one of the things that I'm looking forward to the most today, since we're hosting a tournament, the fact that we have spectate mode. So we no longer have to wait for you or me or whoever's hosting to jump off the edge to their death. We can actually just hop in the lobby, which is probably the sweetest. One of the other things I've really liked about the most recent patches is they've always had a section for community requests. And a lot of times this has to do with things like controller support or for other features. So like recently, for example, they added music and sound sliders, where before it was just high, medium, low. But now you can actually kind of like fine tune it, which is, you know, a request I put in. So shout out to the dev for listening to their community. It's really cool when I see indie developers who are just brilliant at listening to what the community wants and then delivering.
Yeah, definitely. And that's one thing. I know that Disfireco is actually out at a convention right now that the Brawlhalla staff is at. He tweeted me a picture earlier because he knew I was doing this tournament today. But
nice.
But yeah, I mean, it's one of those things. He was going to participate from that convention, but having some computer issues,
Yeah.
He wasn't able to.
Common thing. I think the convention they're at is PAX South.
Yeah, I think it is too.
It's, I mean, hopefully what we see after this is another influx of players or another big update, because usually developer teams be kind of coordinated with that with the live event. So we'll see. Who knows? Maybe after this weekend we'll have another big influx of players interested in the 1v1 side of things.
Yeah, he was telling me that the lines, because he stopped by there and he was going to, you know, talk to the devs and everything, but the lines to get to the four computers they have to play the game were super long. So maybe you're right. Maybe we'll see a lot more influx of players. You know, I can only hope that those people that are coming to play, if they want a beta key, they're giving it out to them there at PAX South. But I also told Dishfire to go ahead and, you know, throw up his laptop and talk to people around that booth and say, hey, there is this tournament going on right now. He does have other stuff he wants to do at PAX South. He's an old friend of mine, works for another production company. But yeah, definitely PAX South for Brawlhalla seems to be going well from what I can hear.
Yeah, I really feel like this game, one of the reasons why I have kept playing Brawlhalla is just because of the fact that there's like this limitless amount of potential with this game. I think that it's the type of game that appeals to casual players, to people who are more competitive. I bet you can grow it infinitely with, you know, more stages, more characters, more special moves, all kinds of things. And, you know, like, I really just wish nothing but the best for Blue Mammoth and the Brawlhalla team. Like, this game's got legs, man.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, we were planning to have, for our next tournament, have some big Smash Brothers players come in, but me not being part of that Smash community, I didn't realize they actually had a big event on the 31st. We thought about changing it, but we are actually going to keep it, you know, the way it is. We're going to keep it next week on the 31st. We're trying to get as many players as we possibly can, just so that we can have a big tournament, kind of test that out before we get kind of that bigger setup going with bigger players from, say, the Smash community and things like that. So I know you're going to be participating in next week's tournament. Right. I mean, what is your goal for that tournament? Is it a win?
You know, honestly, like, I've always felt conflicted about how well I'm doing at Brawlhalla, because I'm normally not the top tier of any game I play. You know, like, League of Legends is an example. Like, I'm, like, bottom middling tier of crapness, you know? in Street Fighter, I was D-rank. You know, normally I'm just above average. So honestly, what I'm really hoping is that eventually I'll find somebody who's better than I am so that I can learn from them. Right now, like, my training partner has been Misfit since we started playing together a couple months ago, and we kind of go back and forth learning from each other. But as far as the next tournament goes, like, I'm going to go in with the mindset to win, but if I get knocked out, that's a good thing too, because I'll have new people that I can spar with.
Yeah, you're always looking for that extra person to fight with, right? I mean, I know I don't put up much of a fight when we play. You've given me a few pointers. I mean, probably the closest person to you is Misfit, and I mean, you know, you've been beating him pretty handily as of late, right?
Yeah, well, part of the thing with me and Misfit is that what I have is a lot of fighting game experience. And the more that I play the same person, the more I'm accustomed to adapting to that person's style. Mm-hmm. And this is something that's really common with people who play each other 1v1 a lot with any type of fighting game. So, for example, in my real life, quote-unquote, there's a friend of mine that I play Injustice with, which is a fighting game with, you know, DC characters.
Yep.
It's put out by the studio made Mortal Kombat. Awesome game. We've been playing each other for almost 2 years. It'll be like 2 years in April, I think. And we play to each other's style. And when my style evolves by one move, I beat him for 10 games. And then he understands what I'm doing. And then he adapts to it and beats me again. Now, this is something Misfit has a little bit of a harder time with, because he doesn't have that, you know, 6 years of fighting game experience that I have.
I feel that. I feel that. I don't have that either.
You know, so, like, that's something that comes along with fighting game experience. But the thing about Misfit is what he does really well is he finds things that work and then uses them in every suitable situation. And he finds the things that are really hard for people to deal with and continues to use and abuse those moves until someone can figure it out. So the reason I've been beating him recently is only because I figured out what he's been doing. But he's been going around molly stomping everybody else because people have a harder time adapting to things on the fly. So really, like, that's kind of, to me, is like the upper echelon of competitive 1v1 with Brawlhalla, is how quickly can you adapt? And that's something that we're going to have to see in this tournament, because with three stocks, you have one stock's worth of mistakes to be able to analyze your opponent, figure out what he's doing and what you're doing wrong, and adapt to it.
Yeah, and that's definitely, I mean, I know you're touching on it. I'm a huge FPS person. That's kind of the way I look at it, the way I come, you know, to it. I know I've discussed with you, my whole strategy is to just kind of be fluid and timing based, and that's, you know, outside of just kind of the twitch, you know, movement with your right hand with the mouse. I mean, a lot of FPS games just kind of fluidity and timing, you know, when somebody crosses your crosshair, that's when you pop it, you know, that things like that from FPS games is what I'm trying to bring to this. I mean, yeah. Is that something that you see is bridging over well, at least with me, or you think could bridge over well?
It's kind of the FPS knowledge for me that crosses over into fighting games is from being able to predict what your opponent's going to do based on the situation. So for instance, in Counter-Strike, you look at the map timer, you look at how many people have died, you look at if the bomb is down on the map or not, and then you predict where the opponent might be and what avenues they're going to use to approach objectives. And then you cover that accordingly. You know, in Brawlhalla, it's about looking at the items that are on the map, seeing how far up or down your opponent is, are they playing aggressive or passively, and then using that information to predict what they're going to do next. So a really common one in Brawlhalla is that they see an item, they go for the item, especially if it's a weapon. So you can often use items as these little mini choke points because you know someone's going to approach that somehow. So you guard the item. Keep them unarmed. You anticipate the fact that they're going to try to dive kick you while they're unarmed, and then you abuse it accordingly. So
yeah,
there is some crossover, but it's something where it's a combination of, you know, prediction and then also being able to execute properly once you're actually in the game.
Yeah, it looks like our first set of free-for-all games, our first round is done, so we do have all of our players for that second round, so we can get our actual ranks in for our bracketing. But it looks like in the first game, or in the top game, Game A, Misfit actually won, with Annx coming in second and Icy Cow coming in third. In our Game B, it looks like... Kreutz did win that one. Weird Jacob came in second, and Zeno came in third. So for our Game C, it does look like Fearless came in first, Binks in second, and Magma Bob in third. So our last game, Game D, it does look like Dyne did take that top spot, Hamaya in the second, and Ninja Fans in the third. So in our second round, our top game going for seeds 1 through 4 are going to be Dyne, Fearless, Kreutzberg, and Misfit. And our mid game going for seeds 5 through 8 are going to be Hamaya, Binks, Jacob, and Annx. For our bottom game, going for seeds 9 through 12 is going to be Ninja Fan, Magma, Zeno, and Icy Cow. So I mean, how do you think this is going to shape up?
Well, it's free-for-all, so it's going to be interesting. I'm actually planning on trying to hop in a spectate mode for one of these games. It's going to be cool. I'm still also trying to figure out just how spectate mode works. If you can actually get in while
yeah,
in the lobby, if we have to wait for the game to start.
The spectate mode is brand new still. They threw it in so that we could have it for this tournament and for the following tournament. The way that you do have to join it at this point is the players in the game have to start their game, and once they go to their loading screen, then you can put in the code and hit OK and you can join the game. So definitely something brand new, very interesting. They are going to work on it. They have asked me for a little bit of feedback on different things like the spectate UI, things that we would need in a spectate mode. So they are working on that. It's just soon to come. I mean, this whole Brawlhalla thing in itself is new.
It's very much in closed beta, and a lot of the, it seems like they're really good at kind of iterating on ideas. You know, like they're looking at things like, okay, spectate mode, let's get that in quick, and then let's listen to feedback and improve on it.
Yeah, definitely.
That's a brilliant, brilliant way to approach game design, especially in a multiplayer online game. So I'm all about it.
Awesome. But yeah, I mean, it's one of those things. They are going to improve it. Not only is the game in a new stage, in a closed beta stage, I mean, all of the tournament stuff is brand new, too. I mean, we had, our first tournament in December, and that was just kind of an impromptu mini-tournament, eight players.
Like, hey, who's online? Let's grab everybody in your friend list.
Let's do it. And then our second one was on the 3rd of this month, and this is our third one so far. So, I mean, we're only at episode 3, basically. It's brand new. I mean...
Yeah, but I think it's great. Like, it's really... You know, the really cool thing about playing a game at this stage of its life cycle is the fact that everybody's really cool. Like, everybody just wants to play the game. Everybody just wants to have a good time. And it's really nice to be part of a closed beta community that feels really tight-knit.
Yeah, definitely. And that, for the most part, has. I mean, there's been a couple of, you know, screw-off people in, say, online games. But for the most part, the... Steam discussions, the community groups that have popped up, all of those people very willing to help, very willing to play together, very friendly people so far. So that community is very, very friendly, as I have said a couple times.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It's kind of actually surprised me, the number of people who are like, hey, let's 1v1. And I'm like, sure. And then I proceed to kick their ass. And then they were like, hey, that was great. Let's do it again. You know? Like, it's really refreshing from the, you know, typical amount of you know, rage and adolescence that you end up getting another team. So.
Yeah, I have an Xbox 360, and I used to play games online. Hey, I enjoyed my 360. There are some games on it I really enjoyed, but there are some people on there that are just not very friendly.
Yeah. Yep.
So yeah, it does look like some of our games are getting started. The players are getting into their games and getting it ready to go. But what game are you going to be looking at, Raidhyn? I know you said you're going to spectate on one.
So I'm watching the one that Dyne posted, so Dyne's bracket. I think that's
going to be Dyne, Fearless, Kreutz, and Misfit. That's going to be our top game for seeds 1 through 4.
Yep. So looking at them right now, whoever's playing Nash is in the lead. Oh, I can probably turn that on, can I? Yeah. Misfit's on Roland. yeah, it looks like Fearless right now is actually in the lead by 2 points. But
oh.
Free for all, so anything can happen in the next 2 minutes. We will see.
Yeah, definitely. So, I mean, we've talked a lot about the game. Let's talk about your YouTube channel. So, I mean, you've put up a lot of Brawlhalla videos, but there is other stuff that you also throw up on there. So what are kind of the series that you're creating right now or going through right now or anything like that?
So Brawlhalla is still a mainstay. I haven't been making as many videos as frequently lately because I've been kind of tied up with work and some other things. But Brawlhalla is still happening. The other two games that I'm making videos of right now is... I just decided to start playing League of Legends again now that Season 5 is starting. So there's a couple of League videos up there. I'm pretty bad at that game. Like, I'm disgustingly bad. I'm in that stage right now where I know what I'm doing wrong but have no idea how to fix it. So, you know, working on it. So those videos are coming a little bit slower while I try to improve my gameplay on that. And then the other game I'm playing right now is called This War of Mine, which is a indie game that came out about 3 months ago. And I started playing it one night and lost about 4 hours to it before I realized what happened. So I turned around and started recording it the next day. So yeah, if you guys are interested, I'd love it if you checked out my YouTube channel. If you haven't already, it's just, you know, my name, Raidhyn. He's got it up there on the screen right now at YouTube. So
yeah. So yeah, I mean, I definitely watch the majority of your videos. I mean, there's a couple of series that I have not watched just because I don't really have the time, and they're not the ones that interest me the most out of yours, because, I mean, if I don't have enough time, I'm only going to watch the ones that interest me the most.
And, like, that's part of the reason why I mix it up, you know? Like, I like to play a lot of different kind of games, and really, I just record whatever I'm playing. Like, I don't go out of the way to to record stuff that I think is going to be popular or something. You know, I just, if I'm playing it, I'll record it. And if, you know, some people will like some of the things and some people won't like some of the other videos. So I do a mix, and either way, I'm having fun because I'm playing them anyway.
Yeah, so a little update. It looks like Xeno doesn't seem to be online right now. So I'm telling that group to go ahead and play without him. In the case that he does show back up, we will give him the bottom seed of that game. So he does have till the end of that game to get in there. And yeah, that's basically it. If not, we'll just pump up everybody on the seedings once these rounds are done. And yeah, we'll have our brackets.
So it looks like the first match or the top bracket free-for-all match just finished up, and it actually was Fearless out on top.
Oh, wow. So Misfit not coming out on top at that point. Very interesting. I know you think he's probably one of the more stronger players. I know we were talking about him earlier. You said he does have some tendencies, and he'll find something that is maybe overpowered at the time or people don't know how to deal with it. I mean, do you see him not getting the number one seed here is maybe, you know, kind of a foreshadowing of what might happen?
I think it's because he played Roland. Roland is terrible in free-for-all because he's so slow. Like, in free-for-all, it's all about getting to kills. It's all about just running to the guy who's at low health and killing him, no matter where he is on the screen. Roland sucks at running. He can't get there in time before somebody else does. So that's why, like, in free-for-all, if you play Hattori or Ada or somebody fast, you win. You just win. Now, Fearless was on Nat, who was really fast.
Yeah.
And, you know, everybody else was on slightly slower characters. You know, we have Roland, Orion, and Lord Brax, all of whom have slower move speed than Nat. Just based on move speed alone, you could call that one. That's my opinion.
Yeah, and it's one of those things, too, you know, in free-for-all, it does benefit to have maybe a faster player, like you said, or maybe even a faster attack speed. But what I like to do when I play free-for-all, and I'm actually choosing players instead of randoming, I like going with someone with high force power, so that very top stat. Just because, you know, if you get a force move just randomly while chasing somebody who has red health, there's more of a likelihood you're actually going to knock them off and KO them as opposed to somebody with, say, 3 force power.
Yeah, I mean, it's a different approach to it. Everybody's got their own thing. My general approach to free-for-all is if I can get in their face, I can stay in their face until they die.
Yeah, and that's free-for-all is definitely weird. I've said it before. I'm not a big fan of the people who, you know, they're opportunists. So you do all of the damage. You take somebody from white to dark red, and then all of a sudden they come in and steal that kill. That always frustrates me, but hey,
I'm the one frustrating you. I'm out there frustrating the crap out of you.
I do the same thing, though. Like, I've started paying attention to the flash of the characters, which that's one of those things that a lot of people talk about in their review videos and such, is that the health bars are way up in the top right. But if you actually look, you actually watch, I've seen some people, you know, suggest it on the discussions that there should be a, you know, a hit. When somebody gets hit, it should show, and it actually does. So if somebody's in red, when they get hit, they actually flash red. And that's really what I'm kind of looking for with my eyes while I'm playing. If there's a little bit of a lull, I do pop up to the top right just to see who is who's, you know, ready to kill. Definitely if I die, I look up there, but I mean, I'm watching with my peripheral vision just to kind of see those flashes. Do you do that kind of same thing in the free-for-all games?
In free-for-all, totally, yeah. I mean, it's something where it's a lot easier. But the way I kind of think about the health bars at the top right is kind of like the mini-map in other games. So it's something where if you've played a lot of different games, you're used to kind of like scanning something off-map to, you know, to get information. So I've kind of gotten used to, you know, if I get a force attack before I go chase after a guy, I kind of look at the top right of the screen and see what the health bars are.
Awesome.
But the indicator on hit really helps a lot, though, so that it lowers the need to do that.
Is Steam having issues for you? Oh, there it is. I was waiting for that that screenshot to come up,
Steam's
and it was taking a while.
Weird thing where it keeps closing down my chat box.
Huh. Interesting. Yeah, so it does look like Steam is having... That's not something on our end that we can fix, but yeah, it looks like our first two games are in... I'm going ahead and updating our little Google document that helps us kind of organize everything. But it looks like in the top game, Fearless, Misfit, Dyne, and Kreutz. So that's going to be your 1 through 4. And then in the middle game, we have Annx, Jacob, Hamaya, and then Binks. Those are going to be your 5 through 8. And then in the last game, I don't think that game is concluded yet. I think that is the one that that was just kind of waiting for a player to show up, so they might still be in their game right now. That game consists of Ninja Fans, Magma Bob, Xeno, and Icy Cow. Xeno, you know, apparently was missing, so he will get that last seed if he does show back up. If not, somebody else is getting a bye. Tell me, how important are those buys? I know you had one last tournament. I mean, is it something that you get colder, or is it something that it's nice to just kind of take a breather and get out of the competition for a minute?
It's nice if you can watch the match of who you're going to be playing next. But honestly, I feel like it's better to actually stay hot throughout the whole thing. Like, there's a big portion of Brawlhalla, and in playing a competitive tournament, where if you're on a streak, you're going to play better. You're going to play more confidently. You're going to play with more confidence in everything that you're doing. And you're just going to... all of the anxiety from, you know, the fear of losing start to go away. Because I think everybody feels that when they're competing, until you get a lot of experience in competing. Which I don't have the most experience in competing. But I still get nerves. When I play in tournaments, I got nerves the last tournament. The first tournament, I was literally shaking during some of the games because it had been so long since I had bothered to compete at anything. So it's something where I do think the bye kind of balances out. Yeah, you're going to get a little cold. You might also garner some information if you're able to watch the match of the guy that you're going to play.
Yeah. So yeah, while I set up these brackets, just kind of tell me... you know, what you're seeing, what you're going to think about these games coming up. So it does look like we're going to have a few players playing each other. I know I haven't gotten that up yet, but if you can figure it out in your head, who in these wildcard round players are you looking to move on? So basically mid-game and bottom-game players, who are you looking to move on right here?
Well, out of the people that I have played on this list, Binks is probably one of the most interesting people to watch because he has a very different playstyle than most other Brawlhalla players. And so the way that he plays is a little bit more difficult to deal with if you haven't seen him before. I know Misfit has played him quite a bit. I've only been able to play him a few times, but if, you know, whoever he faces isn't able to adapt to his style after the first death, you're just going to get knocked out. He plays very differently. I think it's going to be interesting to see how far Kreutz and Jacob go. In this tournament, seeing as they were in the last one, probably would practice quite a bit from there. And then just considering Fearless's performance in the free-for-all match, I'm kind of interested to see what this guy is all about and how well he's going to play.
Yeah, and that's definitely something that we're looking for. So, I'm still doing these brackets up right now, but yeah. Give the people a show, Raidhyn, while I get this done. I don't know what you want to talk about, but I mean, you can kind of give pointers, stuff like that. But I'm running a little bit behind right now.
All right, you take care of that. I'll talk for a minute before I probably disappear to go have a pre-game cigarette. So that's probably going to happen. So if you guys are just tuning in for the first time to this, I noticed that we just had like a tiny little spike of people. Feel free to say hi in the chat. I am going to be watching the chat throughout the stream, so if you have questions or anything like that, feel free to hit me up. Hey, Dinosaur, what's up? What's up? I love it. I love the EVE Online dancing. The only people who use that emoji. Yeah, bets are open. I think I saw some people earlier in the players area in our competitive chat where they were like, all right, so what is it? Do we take a shot during every knockout, or do we take a shot based on the score after each one? So this is exactly what I love to see. When people are turning a esport into a drinking game, that's when you know you're on the road to success.
Yes.
So You know, and a big part of the reason why we're doing these tournaments is, well, obviously the first one is just because they're wicked fun. But two, because, you know, we want to help grow this community. We want to continue to bring in more and more players, more and more people. And then, you know, I've noticed that there's a pretty big level of camaraderie that kind of comes out of these tournaments with players afterwards who are, you know, after a tournament, there's this huge spike in people talking with each other and trying to invite each other to 1v1 matches to get more practice to prep for the next tournament. And, you know, it's just something that warms my old and decrepit heart. It makes me feel so nice.
So, warms your decrepit heart, huh?
It warms it, man. It warms it. Like, you know, Ebenezer Scrooge, but at the end of the Christmas Carol. So yeah, I mean, that's something, and big shout out to Compton EMT, who's been running these mints and doing all the streams. Like, honestly, like, if we did not have the good fortune to have accidentally gotten Compton into this community somehow, we would not be doing any of this stuff, because he's the guy who streams it, organizes it, does all the brackets, communicates with everybody in chat. So mad shout outs to Compton. Because me, I just make YouTube videos. Like, I press a button while I'm playing, and then I chat shit for half an hour. I'm just like, yeah, so, hey, I just killed somebody. You know, that's about the extent of what I do. And just Compton, you man, running all this stuff has been really awesome, and it's been great being able to be a part of this.
Awesome. Yeah, I appreciate that, that shout out there. I am, however, still just kind of going through this, trying to figure out what I'm doing right now, but yeah, thank you for that shout out. So if you guys have some questions for Raidhyn, who is the best player in the game right now, go ahead and shoot those out. I know we have several people watching. I haven't looked at the number so far in the past couple of minutes, but it does look like we have 17 watching. So yeah, go ahead, ask him some questions. I'm going to get these brackets set up and ready to go. It looks like we're at that 30-minute mark, so we're still on time right now, but we will get those games started here in a moment.
Does anyone have questions? Questions. Oh, we have a question. What am I wearing right now? Pajama pants.
Ooh.
Oh, an actual real question, sweet. Search for identity. What kind of stuff would you like for the devs to add to the game? So this is something that a lot of different people have thoughts on, and I think the thing that's really interesting about this is that you kind of have two key players, right? You have kind of casual, and you have the competitive, and I think both groups kind of want different things. One of the key things that I would really like to see is kind of a bigger variance of moveset. Right now, each character has two specials, you know, two moves that are unique to them, regardless of what weapon they have. And I would really like to see more specials added to kind of add a little bit more variety and strategy to, you know, the character picks. Obviously, I'd love to see more maps. I think the maps that they've created so far have been awesome, and I'm really excited to see where that's going to go in the future. And then, you know, beyond that, a lot more of my focus for what I'd like people, like the devs, to add to the game, or kind of eventually going to evolve into the tweaks as far as the things that I see, like, oh, this move should be nerfed, this weapon set should be improved, and that kind of thing. We just haven't gotten to that point in development yet where I think there's some good things for the devs to be thinking about. Alright, so Sods or Sods asks, what kind of chair do I use? I use a executive leather chair that's very creaky. You can probably hear it because I bought it at, like, I don't know, where did I buy this? Office Max or some crap. It squeaks. But it, you know, it has armrests made out of fake brown leather. It swivels. It's got wheels where I'm constantly rolling over my Xbox cable. So, yes. That's the kind of chair I use. Not sure if I like it anymore. Might have to trade it out for something. Hey! You're welcome, Sods. Or Sods.
The worst part about doing these brackets is I don't have it all set up exactly the same between my bracket and my imagery, so I'm having a little bit of an issue.
That's alright.
It happens.
Alright, so what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to take 5.
Okay.
Do you want to run the trailer?
Yeah, I can go ahead and run that trailer one more time while I get the brackets sorted out, and I can throw up the BRB after all that's right, done. So yeah, guys, we will be back momentarily with your actual brackets. Thank you.
Brawlhalla. Bodvar. Cassidy. Orion. Lord Brax. Nav. Queen Nine. Hattori. Sir Mullen. Scarlet. Ada. Sentinel. Lucian. Three. Two. One. Brawl!
Alright, so we should have the bracket set up. Does look like it is correct here. So, yeah. Yeah, it looks pretty, doesn't it? Looks pretty, guys. So, yeah, apologies for that, all of that delay right there. I was just trying to get all of this set up properly because I realized I don't have it numbered properly on my imagery. So I had to actually number it properly, you know, by hand and get it ready to go. So we do have our bracket. I know that, that Raidhyn is taking a little bit of time to go have a smoke before we do start the games. Shame on him for breaking his New Year's resolution. He said he was going to stop smoking. I don't know if he is back yet or not, but yeah, our games are up and ready to go. So yeah, it looks like we are going to have Magma versus Binks, and then Annx versus Xeno. On the other side of the bracket, we are going to have Icy Cal versus Hamaya, and then Jacob versus Ninja. So those are our games that are going to be played. I'm going to go ahead and let them know. Let me go ahead and get that share for them. If you guys would like to see the actual spreadsheet we're using, there is the spreadsheet. So all of these games are going to be played concurrently. Three stock, best of one. So yeah, that's basically how it's going to be. Just to kind of get things going, get things ready to go. Our goal is an hour to an hour and a half for this entire tournament, for these mini tournaments. So for our larger tournament coming in at the end of the month on the 31st, next Saturday, we're actually going to take as long as we can. We're going to stream, I believe, every single game. We're going to have another streamer coming in as well to do one half of the bracket, and I will do the other half of the bracket. Once we get to those semis, he'll join me, we'll cast together, and then he's going to break off again for that third place game, and I will be doing the championship game. So that's how next week is going to work. But so far, this is pretty smooth. I mean, we're at 12:38 right now. We started those games at noon. We got through two rounds already of FFA. Got everything ready to go. So, yeah, we have our bracket set. We're just waiting for Raidhyn to come back in these games. What are the settings? Best of one. Three stock, best of one. So yeah, we're going to get those games going real quick, get them out of the way, and then we will start with those quarterfinals. So right now, it looks like the buys are going to be Fearless getting a buy, Kreutzberg getting a buy, Misfit getting a buy, and Dyne getting a buy. Additionally, it looks like Annx might have a buy because Xeno, as far as I know, is a no-show for these later rounds. So it looks like, yeah, I did a lot of rhyming there. A buy because Xeno is nowhere to be found. Yes, you guys can start now. Yeah, they can definitely start now. Semis, or no. Next round and quarters, semis, and finals will all be streamed. So don't start this wild card round, though, will not be streamed. So yeah. We are waiting for those games to conclude. Once they do, we will have our quarterfinals, and we're going to get started. Do-do-do! So, yeah, hey. There's our bracket. Who do you guys think is going to win? No, Barrel. I would not be upset if they had like a Mario. If they added extra stuff for kind of solo players to do, things like that, I have no problem with that. If you play it online too, that just increases the amount of playability that the game has. So, hey, I'd probably find myself playing it. I did a couple streams where I just played the single player tournament when it was arcade, set all my high scores, and then, you know, I've set high scores again for all of those characters, did them all on stream as well. So, I mean, I'm a big proponent of having some type of other offline type of stuff to do. For me, it's great that they have that in there. It looks like they're going to be bringing more, as if you look down here in the bottom, there is a missions. I guess you guys can't see, but at the very bottom of your Brawlhalla beta, your actual menu, there's a missions button that is, as you can hear, I'm clicking it, but nothing's happening. So, yeah, that's my opinion on that. But yeah. So any other questions out there in the audience as we wait for these wildcard games to complete? So yeah, if your stream is black, you can go ahead and reload it, and it should go ahead and start playing again. So yeah, we had Barrel Boy asking, you know, if we were opposed to any type of Mario Party style board game multiplayer campaign in Brawlhalla, or maybe even a single player. What's your thoughts on that?
You know, I'm totally fine with things like that. I feel that there's when you make a game like this, it's important to keep it well-rounded, you know, and try to make things that are good for all sorts of types of players. So for me, if that means that more people are going to come in for a game mode like that and have a lot of fun, and people are having fun playing it, then it's a good thing. You know, I mean, I don't ever think that things like that will ever detract from the competitive side of a fighting game. I think that it's really good for getting in more players, and, you know, eventually some of those players will transition to the more competitive side, and, you know, some of those players will just tell their friends, and those people will come in, and I think that it's good. Whatever helps grow the game, I'm all for it.
Yeah. So now that I have the brackets up, I mean, we have the games that are being played right now. Who do you think is going to come out on each of these wildcard round games? I mean, we have Magma and Binks. We have Xeno and Annx. Annx is going to get a bye. So don't even worry about that game. Icy Cow, Hamaya, and then Ninja and Jacob.
Well, I know Jacob's been improving quite a lot in the last couple weeks. The last time I saw him play, he was playing significantly better than how he did in the last tournament. Binks, I'm really excited to watch because I've played some matches with him, and I think he's going to do pretty well. The rest of these people I haven't seen before, so I'm really excited to see what the level of play is that they're going to be bringing out, and if they're going to be using any new tactics that I haven't seen before. And, you know, honestly, I'm just looking forward to being able to watch the games and kind of talk through everything that the players are doing as it happens.
Yeah, definitely. So it does look like we have our first results in, and Jacob moves on over Ninja. So, yeah. Looks like in the chat, Ninja just started getting anxious, and Weird Jacob said his heart's still beating. He can hear it right now. You ever get those moments, Raidhyn?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's how you know it is when the pressure's on, and that certainly happened to me in the previous tournaments where... Man, like, especially when you're on the back foot and you see somebody else doing really good, like, you're just freaking out trying to do everything that you can. I mean, there were some moments where I was down by, you know, a life and a half and barely managed to come back. You know, last tournament when I played Misfit, I feel like I was about to have a heart attack when I was playing it. And you can hear that on the recording of that match that I put up on my channel. Yeah, it's crazy. I did just see now in the chat, Search for Identity was asking another question if they're what we would think about an option for voice chat when playing online. And I think that's actually a really interesting idea. I think that it's something that is really good in certain scenarios. When you're playing free for all online with random people you don't know, probably don't want to have voice chat because inevitably there will be somebody trolling. With some sort of awful dubstep and, like, their little sister crying in the background.
Yeah.
But I think it's something that's an interesting choice for 1v1s and for a potential practice mode because when you're sparring with someone, it's really helpful to be able to talk through what's happening and to kind of give each other feedback as you're playing. And seeing as it is on Steam, you know, potentially there's the chance that it would just integrate a built-in Steam chat, but we'll have to see. That kind of thing, I mean, it might be nice eventually, but it would be something I imagine that would happen like long after the game is actually released. Alright, so we have another question from Dinosaur.
Yep.
Raidhyn, how do you feel about weapons currently, best and worst, in your opinion? So, I personally believe that the sword is the best weapon in Brawlhalla right now. And there are a couple of reasons for this, but basically, it's good in every situation. It's probably one of the most balanced out of all of them. There's no real downside. It has some of the fastest startup moves. I think that a close second is probably the spear, more so because of its utility and how easy it is to throw the item. Throwing your weapons right now is a really huge part of the current competitive meta, and people who are able to throw their weapons effectively tend to come out with a much bigger advantage. After that, I feel like the rest of the weapons all kind of have their strengths and weaknesses. I don't really think that there is a worst weapon. If I had to choose one, it would probably be, for at least the 1v1 situations, it would probably be the blades, just because they're the most difficult to use and they're the hardest to punish correctly. You can't really get punishes off with blades as easily as you can with other weapons. But yeah, that's kind of how I think about it. It's like sword, then spear, then everything else.
Yeah, so it looks like we have all of our wildcard games done now. So Binks over Magma. As I said before, Annx getting a bye versus Xeno because Xeno disappeared. Jacob beating Ninja and Hamaya beating Icy Cow. So our first game up that we're going to be viewing here for our quarterfinals is going to be Fearless versus Binks. So Binks moving on out of that 8 spot, moving up to fight Fearless at this point. They are getting the game set up. We do have a pin ready to go in the custom in the chat there, if you want to grab that and get ready there, Raidhyn.
All right. And these are all happening one by one by one, right?
Yes, one by one by one. Doo-doo. All right, so let me go ahead and get my hitbox, my obs up as well. What transition do you want, Raidhyn?
Oh, you know I like the Thatch.
I figured as much, but yeah, let's go ahead and hit that thatch, jump on over to the main screen. We do have our game. And yeah, you guys can see the pin. It doesn't really matter since, you know, I guess it does because you might be able to jump in the game. But yeah, start, guys. I will need to get that, get a box covering that.
That room number.
Yeah.
That, 1 million people. Do not try to spectate this in game. We're trying to minimize the amount of lag could happen with too many people trying to watch the game. So
that and I don't want people to join in it. There we go, waiting for a game to start. So I am jumping in right now. Where's my controller? There it is. I want to be able to see who this is and who they are. So, I went to the wrong, Alright.
Looks like the match is starting up. We've got Binks on Hattori and Fearless on Nash.
I will.
Alright. Yeah, you are right. So Fearless on Nash, Binks on Hattori, but we do see a lot of those throws coming out from Binks. I know you've played him. For me, he does seem to have pretty good distancing on his attacks. Is that the way you saw it?
Yeah, one of the things that Binks is really good at is using his weapons as kind of a spacing tool, so he's constantly on the attack, but more using it as a way to guard against approaches. But Nash is able to get a really good hit, sending Binks towards the bottom of the stage, and there he goes for the first knockout.
Yeah, so going down so quickly and so early with Fearless having only, say, maybe 30-40% on health if you're a Smash player and that's kind of the way you look at it. Do you think this is really bad for Binks right now?
Yeah, I mean, now he's on the back, but he's going to have to play really carefully in order to make up that health lead. So he's trying to do a good job of guarding his weapons. As you can see, he's kind of positioning himself over where he thinks Fearless wants to go. And Fearless is having a really hard time picking up one of these weapons. He gets the spear just now. And as you can see, like, Fearless is doing a really good job of throwing his weapon. Pretty much at every point that he knows he can land a hit, he's tossing it, and Binks isn't reacting very well.
Yeah, and it looks right now like he's got Binks kind of in. Oh, and there goes Binks. Can he make it back? He does. So they're both at red right now. So there's a full life advantage that Fearless has right now over Binks.
Yep, and this is just what I was talking about, how the weapons, why the spear is so good. It is super easy to hit people with the spear because of how huge the hitbox is. And Fearless knows that and is using it to his advantage. He's now up 2 lives to 1.
Yeah, and really for me, the spear too, I mean, just the trajectory on it is better than any other weapon. In fact, I really like the hammer too, as we do see Fearless go down for his first life there. All Binks needed to do was get a force hit on him. But yeah, I mean, both of Nash's weapons, real great for throwing.
Yeah, definitely. Whenever I play Nash, I always try to throw as much as possible. We can see here Nash is again unarmed and calls in the Valkyria Horn and picks up a spear. So, yep, the weapon toss comes out again. And Fearless is doing a really good job here.
I mean, he went probably 6, 7, 8 hits right there without Binks even touching him. But Binks does get the bomb bounce off on him, so we're even at 1-1. Granted, Binks with the health deficit here.
It's definitely not impossible to come back in this situation. Binks has to just play really carefully and start predicting those throws.
Yeah, it's not going to work, though. I mean,
the early dodge, and yep, I don't think he's going
to
make it.
Yeah, so it looks like Binks is going to be dropped by Fearless in that one. All right, Binks, thanks for coming. Fearless, congratulations for moving on. So, yeah, there's our first game, guys. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and hit that transition on over. We'll go with Hattori this time. We're going to go over to that 16-man bracket and get an update for you guys. So, yeah, on the left here, it does look like Fearless moving on. And boom. It is updated for you guys on the bracket. So it looks like we got Kreutzberg and Annx. So Kreutz and Annx get a game up and give us the pin. So while we're waiting, I'm actually going to switch back over to that main tournament screen. I'm going to get us a nice
custom
blocker up for that room number. But I mean, what did you see in that game from Fearless? I don't know how much you've played against Fearless, but what did you see that you liked? What did you see that you didn't like?
Well, the big thing that I saw that was really important was his ability of just throwing his weapon at every opportunity. Throws right now are a huge part of the Brawlhalla competitive meta, and it's something that Fearless was doing incredibly well, and Binks just wasn't able to react to it. Binks wasn't, you know, willing to give up his weapon at all, and it was just, it had him on his back foot the entire time, because every time you throw a weapon, if you hit, you get free damage. You know, it's pretty much the only distance slash zoning tool you have in the game, and people who are able to incorporate throwing their weapons into the playstyle tend to come out on top.
Yeah, I definitely feel that same way. So I'm going to go ahead and just cover up my whole pin pad, and we should be good at that point. So I'm going to jump back over to that 16-man bracket so you guys can see what's going on. It does look like we have a game up, pin up. So when we let them know to start, we can get that game started. But yeah, who are you looking for in this game between Kreutz and Annx?
Well, I'm not sure how long Annx has been playing. I know Kreutz has a little bit more experience. I think last time he got to the quarterfinals in the last tournament. So I'm just interested to see how this is going to play out. Now, you know, Fearless is a great example of someone who came in. I haven't seen him play before and did an excellent job. So maybe we'll see the same thing coming out of Annx here.
Yeah, definitely. So, yeah, are you ready to get this game started?
Yep.
I am too. So let's go ahead and give them the start. Go ahead and let them know to start the game.
Alright.
Alright, so here we go. I am up. I am ready. And once they get started, we can go ahead and get joined into that game.
Alright. Yeah.
Sweet. Nope. Jack Vrax, no love out of Barrel Boy coming from the chat. It's hard to fight someone who teleports everywhere. Oh, Binks throwing out the teleporting. The teleporting. That's how I felt about you, Binks, when we used to play. I mean, the teleporting, stuff like that, you know. So, yeah, all right, game is starting. So I'm going to go ahead and once it gets in, I'm going to take off that blocker. Boom. We are ready to go. So it looks like Annx with Ada, Kreutzberg with Lucian, the new character. So what are you seeing out of Lucian here? What do you hope to see from Kreutzberg out of Lucian?
I'm hoping to see a lot of signature moves. I think that Lucian has some of the best signature moves in the game, especially for punishing mistakes. But it's a little bit harder to use them effectively. Now, this is a good stage for Lucian because of the long horizontal platform here on the bottom, and he kind of needs that space. Right now, Kreutzberg is doing a really good job of doing damage to Ada while she's in the air.
Yeah, it's definitely at the point where he is getting a little bit of advantage on his health. And I know that not a lot of players are really good with those Katars, but since Lucian's come out, a lot of people have liked kind of his look, so they've spent a lot more time getting used to those Katars.
There's the first knockout.
Yeah, and it looks like Ada goes down, so Kreutzberg gets the first kill over Annx. He does have that skin on his Lucian. I mean, how do you feel about the skins that are in this game so far?
This particular skin I dig a lot. I actually picked this one up for Lucian, even though I'm terrible with him. But yeah, this is really interesting. It seems right now like Annx is not really sure what to do. He's kind of doing things where he's like, I know I should throw things, but he doesn't know at what point to throw. And so we've seen a lot of misses out of him, and Kreutz is just doing a really good job of controlling the air right now, and he gets another knockout.
Oh, so we might see a 3-0 right here. You think it's going to happen?
I mean, right now it looks like it's certainly possible. Yep, gets the bomb hit on Ada. Ada looks like she's going to go for the mine. There we go, another miss throw coming out of Ada. I think both characters are waiting for a weapon to drop.
Ooh, almost getting hit right there by the mine. Annx almost got hit, but from coming into this tournament, I know I was talking with Skroyan, and he thinks that, you know, Kreutz has really stepped up his game, might be one of the top competitors now.
Well, if that's what Skroyan says, I'm tempted to believe him.
Alright,
and there it is.
There it is.
3-0.
Yeah, so that's what we got. 3-0. Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and...
I mean, that's where you can really see the experience and the practice payoff for Kreutz. As, you know, like I said, I'd imagine that he'd spent a lot of time between this tournament and the last one practicing up and getting more experience. And he did an amazing job of controlling the map, controlling the airspace, and basically punishing Ada for not being able to move around the map effectively.
Yeah, definitely. So I'll go ahead and update that bracket. I mean, our next game is going to be Misfit versus Hamaya. So give us kind of a rundown on that game.
Well, Hamaya, I haven't seen play. So the thing with Misfit is you got to watch out for his ability to just put you in bad situations and then take advantage of you. He's pretty good at playing a really balanced game of both aggressive and defensive. And it's going to be really interesting to see if Hamaya is able to deal with Misfit's onslaught.
Yeah, definitely. I know that I had a very frustrating game versus Misfit earlier this week. He's a really good player. Hamaya, I know I did a lot before I took that week off to do kind of the Tecmo Los Angeles stuff that I did, that tournament. If you guys want to see some footage of that tournament, it is up on my YouTube. We had a lot of technical difficulties at the beginning, but hey, we got through it. But yeah, I mean, Hamaya, I've played a lot with Hamaya. He is a new budding player. He does have a lot of improvement to do. I think Misfit, unless something drastically goes wrong, is probably going to take this game, at least in my opinion.
All right, well, let's see what happens. I think they're in the lobby right now. Can we give them a go ahead to start?
So let me go ahead and get ready for that. Watch game. Let's go ahead and put that pin in. All right, so let me go ahead and get that transition going, and then we can go ahead and jump on over and tell them to get started. So I'm going to give you Thatch again, because you just love Thatch.
Indeed. So this is going to be really interesting, because I know Misfit is feeling a little bit of nerves right now, but from what you've said, this is kind of his game to lose. So we'll see what happens. Let's hope that we don't have any strange lag issues.
Yeah.
And, you know, we can get a good fight. So
give him the go-ahead, and we can get this started.
All right, just told them to go ahead and get started now.
And they are.
It looks like they're in. All right, so we should expect to see Misfit on Hattori here. And it looks like Ada is going to be played by Hamaya, which is a really interesting matchup because Ada is probably one of the better characters to deal with Hattori. And Misfit picks up the spear first, and it's just starting to go now for the weapon control.
Yeah, I really think it's one of those things that... Hey, Ada has the speed to match up with Hattori, so yeah, that would definitely be why she is one of the best players to play against Hattori with.
Yep, and you can see right now Misfit is just doing his best to try and control the weapons on the map. Ada gets her first hit in, and Misfit, as you can see, is just trying to throw his weapon whenever the opportunity presents itself.
Yeah.
Maintaining good spacing.
And one of the things you always tell me about Misfit, and this might be something for people looking to try to beat Misfit, is there's always that dodge right. So I keep seeing that come out from him here already early in this game.
Yeah, it is something that he favors quite a bit. He dodges a lot. He dodges into people, he dodges away from people. He's really good at kind of deciding when to do it. And usually that's the only way that I beat him, is kind of trying to do the hard thing and waiting for him to dodge first and then punishing him for it.
Yeah, so would you say he's probably one of the best dodgers in the game, or...?
Yeah, I think so. I think he's one of the better defensive players in using the dodge properly.
And so we do see that a spear coming out of Misfit. Hamaya right now with no weapon, throwing a couple of amaze balls around, but if Hamaya cannot solidly get a hold of a weapon and keep it, do you think he's going to be, you know, at a deficit here?
Yeah, Misfit is doing a really great job of making him work to pick up any weapon on the map, and this is what I was talking about earlier with the strategy of kind of map control in Brawlhalla. See, Misfit's going to toss his weapon here and pick up the next one, and with this, it just puts Hamaya on the back foot, and right now you can see him feeling it. You know, he's trying to go underneath, trying to avoid it. Misfit punishes him for it, and now he's just on the edge.
Oh, and we do get a weapon throw down, something that I personally like to do, but it's a great way to just kind of edge guard without putting yourself in a dangerous position with your down heavy.
Yep, and we finally got Misfit unarmed with Ada on pistols, so this should be interesting. We're going to get some more weapon tosses. Ada dodges right through it. Oh, and lands an up heavy attack.
That could have been very dangerous for Misfit if that would have been contacted on, say, a second jump as opposed to a first.
Man, this is just pretty intense. We're seeing a lot of uppercuts, and Misfit lands one, knocking Hamaya out of the stage. Misfit picks up the spear, and I mean, right now you can expect Misfit. He's going to get in the air, toss his spear, and pick it up again. He's going to toss his spear, pick it up.
Wow!
That is a key part of how Misfit plays, and the thing is that if you don't expect it coming, it's very safe. Misfit's usually able to retrieve his weapon, and you know, a lot of people just don't expect it, because one of the things that Misfit does is he maintains his air height. If he knows that if he's far above you, he's got some positional advantage, and it's something that he does that most players don't.
Yeah, and a little trickery coming out of Hamaya there, where he dropped down and then threw the bomb up at Misfit. Misfit did get out of the way. Oh, Hamaya catching the bomb!
Catches the bomb, alright. So nothing came of it, but still awesome. Misfit punishes the item call, throws the bomb straight down, and they're both knocked out to end the match.
Yeah, double knockout to end it. So, yeah, one accident for Misfit as I drop a bunch of cans and stuff off my desk. But
I don't think that was an accident at all. I think that was intentional. That was
reactionary. That's what that was.
If I explode both of us, I win the match. And that's what Misfit did. Great fight.
Yeah, so we're going to go ahead and throw that blocker back up, and then we're going to go ahead and transition over to that bracket again. So, I mean, what did you see in that match, say, coming out of Hamaya? I mean, what would you like to see him do better in order to maybe move on to another round next time?
I mean, this was just a really good example of Misfit controlling the map and Hamaya not being sure how to deal with it. It's something where when I'm put in this situation where someone is guarding weapons or, you know, keeping me unarmed, I just avoid them. You know, I stay on the opposite side of the map. I expect people to throw things at me and dodge them. And then I wait for another weapon to spawn until I can go and approach people on equal footing. But, you know, most of the time, Hamaya was trying to engage with Misfit while he was unarmed. And it just put him at a disadvantage throughout the whole match.
Yeah, and it does look like they were waiting for us, so yeah, they already have a game up here. Our next game is going to be Dyne versus Jacob. I mean, yeah, give me your thoughts on this one.
Well, Dyne is really interesting. I believe I've played a few matches with him, and I know that he's got a lot of motivation. Jacob, I haven't played 1v1 in a very long time. But I know, much like Kreutz, he was at the last tournament. He did better than most people expected. and I would imagine he's been spending a lot of time towards improving his gameplay since then. So I think it'll be really good to kind of see what happens and how these players are able to, you know, come to the Brawl.
Yeah, so it does look like Misfit moving on, but we are going to get on with this next game of Dyne and Jacob. I'm going to go ahead and run us on over to that main tournament screen, and we're going to give them the go-ahead. So yeah, go ahead and give them the go-ahead at this point.
All right, go-ahead given.
All right.
Whoop, accidentally joined as a player. Didn't want to do that.
It's okay, you got time, you got time.
All right. Let's see how this goes.
If they're paying attention.
Begin.
Go ahead and start. Begin. Commence. Oh, good times, good times.
Oh, here we go. It looks like we are coming into the match right now.
All
momentarily,
right.
Any second.
And, there it
oh,
is.
Oh, man, we are playing at Titan's End. This is going to be really interesting.
Oh, jeez. I'm getting an unknown for both players, so...
Well, this will be fun and interesting. you know, in this matchup, I kind of have to favor Ada, just because I think Ada's slightly stronger, but the thing is that that's usually related to her signature moves. And in this case, her signature moves are kind of useless. She might be able to use the signature move from the guns, but... You know, it's gonna be hard. Titan's End is a really challenging map to use your character in the way that you're accustomed to in other positions.
Yeah, and see, I was gonna say Thatch definitely as you know, having the hammer, which is a more vertical weapon, with this map being a more vertical map, might actually have the advantage over Ada. But we do see that first kill.
The first kill.
Yeah, Thatch throwing a mine at Ada, grabbing that first kill, now picking up a hammer. That is a Heartseeker hammer. That was for charity, actually. I know you picked one of those up. I'd hope we see quite a few more of those coming out.
Yeah, I think the charity event was really cool, and it's nice to see Nash, not that. Nash.
Sorry, I always do that. I don't know why. Nash.
On the attack. It looks like right now they're just kind of waiting each other out. Oh, the taunt comes out from Ada. She's not going to play into this. She knows exactly what Nash wants to do, and it looks like she's finally going to get impatient, and they're going to go back to it. And that's something that I've seen before in competitive matches where players know what the other guy wants. And, you know, sometimes you got to be a little unwilling to play into it.
Yeah, and we saw a double throw there. Spear from Ada missing, but Nash's hammer hitting. We do have guns now out of Ada, which is probably the, you know, the better weapon maybe here on this map.
Yeah, I think guns are really, really useful in this map. Like you said, I think hammers are also really good, and we see two item throws coming out at the same time from both players. So they're thinking the same, another item throw from Nash. The hammer is a great item for throws, and Ada gets the knockout.
Yeah, so it's a 2-2 right now. Ada probably at about 40-50% on the health bar.
Yep, certainly not a deficit that you can't come back from, but Ada really needs to get a weapon here. Oh, and Nash dodges backwards into the landmine, a mistake that I have made myself countless times.
Oh, it's always embarrassing, especially when you throw it yourself and then a couple seconds later dodge back away from a move and land right on it. That's probably the worst.
Yep, we've got spear v spear coming out. I would like to see more weapon tosses downwards coming out from people, and there's one right now from Ada.
Yeah, ask and you shall receive, my friend. Ask and you shall receive. But yeah, it does look like Ada using that forward light tilt quite a bit in this game. It's one of those things that really does kind of protect you. The reach on it is pretty good.
Amazing move coming out underneath from Ada.
Yeah,
that was
going
pretty sick.
I mean that pillar, that's something that I try to use myself when somebody's just trying to sit there and cheese me off of that tower, as we do see a suicide bomb come out, so there it's 0% health. But yeah, I mean going underneath that pillar there is definitely a great kind of strategy to do if somebody's trying to cheese you, just wall hugging that pillar.
Oh man, we've got great moves coming out from Ada right now. She's been able to put a whole lot of damage on the Nash without taking any herself. One of the things I'm seeing both of these players do is kind of dodging at similar moments, and Ada just eats a bomb.
Yeah, I mean, those mines, they're great in some ways. Personally, I like... Oh, we see a taunt coming out.
Here comes the salt shaker.
The gauntlet has been thrown right there. We'll see if that salt shaker says anything about this match.
Alright, gets the quick Valkyria Horn call, does some damage onto Ada with that. Oh, nice item toss.
And oh, there it is!
Gets the knockout, there it is, that strength coming out from Ada to close out the match.
Gonna pour some salt on that wound. Pour it right on.
You feeling salty yet, son?
So yeah, I have no idea who was who in that match, but who was who? I'm asking in the chat because I have no idea.
Weird Jacob was Nash.
Okay, so yeah. Sorry, Weird Jacob, you did lose, but that was a great game that you played. We're going to go ahead and get that that Hotori transition over to the bracket. All right. So, yeah, we're going to pause a little bit right here to get some social media posts out, but it looks like we are on our semifinals as Dyne does move on over Jacob. So, our next match is going to be Fearless versus Kreutzberg. Kreutzberg really wanting to face Misfit, but he's going to have to get past Fearless right now, who just kind of moved his way up to that number one spot and has just kind of moved on through the bracket.
Yeah, and these final matches, these semifinals are going to be really interesting to watch just because now you know how everyone plays, you know that they're on equal footing, you know that they're both capable and competent, and we're going to have some really good matches coming up.
Yeah, definitely. So I'm going to go ahead and get those social media posts out. We suggest that you guys throw it out too, definitely, because we're on our semifinals here. We're stepping up to a best of three format from here on out. So Fearless and Kreutz coming up, we're going to see three games out of them. I know a lot of people don't like the best of one. Really, it's just the time thing that we do to get these mini tournaments done as quickly as possible. But for the semis and the finals, we do a best of three on both. So yeah, let's get those social media posts out, guys. Everybody that's watching this needs to be getting a social media post out saying, hey, come check out this tournament. Semis are about to start. Semis starting now. All right, so I'm sending out that post. I'm going to make sure it came up, because sometimes when I use the dashboard, it does not come up. Let's go ahead. Oh. All right. So let me go ahead and check my profile, make sure it came out. Semis starting now. Sweet. So yeah, Fearless and Kreutz getting the game. All right, looks like they are already setting up that game. Three stock, best of three, guys, just as a heads up. Good luck, have fun. Wait for us to say start. All right, so yeah, Fearless and Kreutz, what are you looking to see out of these two players, Raidhyn?
Well, what Fearless showed us in his match was that he's very capable with weapon throws. What Kreutz showed us is that he's really good at controlling the map and airspace. So we're just going to have to see how these two play styles collide and who's going to come out on top.
All right, so with that, we're going to go ahead and get on over to our main tournament screen. Throw up that blocker. I still have the previous game screen up, but we're going to go ahead to the watch game with the blocker up. That is our pin.
All right, should I give these guys the go-ahead?
Yeah, you can definitely give them the go-ahead at this point.
All right, go ahead, given. 2871. Wait, I did not just say that. It was 2,648.
Because
679 plus 8.
679 plus 8 with the square root of 3.
Yeah,
all
with
right.
The square root of the cosmic knowledge of nonsense and disaster stuff. Let's see if we get character names this time around. Fearless.
Fearless,
yep.
We do.
Fearless on Nash, and
Kreutzberg is going to be once again on Lucian.
Alright, so let's see how this plays out. Nash gets the first weapon with the spear, tosses it out, and Lucian on guns.
Yeah, it looks like both players playing a little defensively until they did get there and mixed it up a bit. But
man,
both
Lucian's doing a great job of this airspace once again, using that air attack with the guns just to kind of keep Nash at bay.
Yeah, and that might be one of the most used moves on that weapon set, throwing a lot of stuff out here, a couple of mace balls. Yeah, I mean, right now, from what you're seeing on this first live, do you really think that Fearless has an opportunity to win this?
Yep, Fearless is on the back foot right now. I mean, Kreutz is doing a great job on Lucian, just trying to maintain the space, and it's something where you can feel the pressure, and especially in a tournament situation, when you're on the back foot, it hurts a lot.
Yeah, I know. You've put me on the back foot quite a bit. You know, as soon as I get momentum, you take it right back. But we do see a late hammer throw coming out of Fearless there, so he does still get hit. I've noticed with the new patch and the new changes that's been happening a lot more. You can't get those really late throws to kind of save yourself from being hit anymore.
Yeah, let's see. Both characters on really low health right now. We're going to see who's able to get the first knockout. It looks like Kreutzberg pulls it off.
Yeah, Kreutzberg with his Lucian, so...
I mean, this is going to be really interesting to see, because it's a best of three now, if Fearless is going to be able to adapt what he's doing to deal with Lucian. There we go, we get a down item toss coming out from Fearless, and a lot of damage.
Oh, long throw!
Oh, that was... brilliant.
Beautiful. That was beautiful. I don't know if I've seen a spear throw come out that well by you, let alone anyone else, and we just saw it.
Well, there's some on tape. I did it to Misfit last night. It was gorgeous. He was so salty. But here we are, we're looking at Fearless and Kreutz. Kreutz, again, is just trying to like stay in the air, and he's been doing a great job of getting his diagonal attacks off. And blades are one of the fastest weapons in the game, if not the fastest, and it's incredibly difficult to punish them with any weapon, and almost impossible with a hammer because of how close they are to you.
Yeah, and that's one thing that, you know, when you're looking at, say, playing Sentinel, you have to play both weapons very differently with him. I mean, he's not in this game right now, as we do see Kreutzberg get another kill there with that tilt, but, I mean, the hammer... you have to keep people at a distance, keep everything timed really well. And with the Katars, you have to be really close combat, right up in their face. And, you know, you're not as much a timing as you are just kind of a hit and run.
Yeah, and Kreutzberg is just looking really, really solid on the Lucian, and he's got great movement. He seems to be using all of the right attacks at the right time. And... yeah, I would not want to be fighting this guy right now.
Hey, you may be fighting him next week.
Oh,
come next week.
The signature move,
dude. That is one of the hardest signatures to land.
Yeah, it really is.
We see some nice good edge guarding, but they come out of the middle.
Dangerous situation. Ooh. Just barely manages to dodge the bomb. Almost gets the bounce.
A mace ball to the face. Yeah, and a mace ball to the face. I mean, I love those things.
There's the final knockout with the landmine toss. Coming out from Kreutzberg, so looks like he takes the first match.
Yeah, so what started out as kind of a rout turned into a good game, and then just kind of a quick finish there. But Fearless, we thank you for coming. Definitely jump into the tournament on the 31st. Sign-ups that are still open.
This is best of three, right?
That's right. This is best of three. So, yeah, we'll see what Fearless does coming out in the second game. So, yeah, let's go ahead and throw that blocker back up. I'm going to go ahead and throw that same game number in if I can find it. Dang it, people talking so much. Go ahead and put it in the chat again for me, just so I don't have to go looking for it.
I believe it is this.
Alright.
And I'll let him know when to start.
Alright, let me get all set up and ready to go here. Alright, I'm ready to go. So you can tell him to start whenever you want.
Alright, just gave him the go-ahead, and it should be getting back in. It'll be interesting to see if they stay on the same characters or not. You know, I'm not really sure about how people decide to have mains in this game, but, you know, for me, I'm always willing to counterpick if I think that there's somebody who's stronger against certain types of characters. It looks like we're on the stadium once again. And same characters.
Same characters.
On Lucien and Fearless on Nash.
Yeah, we are getting an unknown coming up again, but at least, hey, we know the characters. So Fearless taking that first hit coming out of Kreutzberg right there.
And oh, no! An amazingly early knockout coming from the bomb setup. That was incredibly unlucky for Fearless.
Yeah,
that's,
I mean,
going to be painful.
With such an early lead and no hits on him, Kreutzberg with a huge advantage right now. I mean, with having won the last game, I mean, over the course of the series, you know that Fearless is definitely on his back foot right now in that matter as well.
Yeah. And we're seeing a lot of the same tactics coming out from Kreutzberg, and this is kind of what I was talking about before, is, you know, at this point, Fearless should know what he's trying to do and should be able to deal with it. But, you know, that's one of the challenges, especially in a tournament setting. It's really difficult to be able to think that clearly when you're under pressure.
Yeah, we do see him coming out with a couple more of those timing tilt attacks. But, I mean, it's one of those things that he needs to really look at what Kreutzberg is doing when he has those blades. Because the blades really are kind of what hurt him last time. One of the greatest things about the blades is the down light while you're in the air functions very much like the dive kick we see in Unarmed. One of the greatest ways to counter out that dive kick is with the hammer. So your down tilt attack, or your down heavy tilt, is probably the best way to deal with that, because it just snatches him out of the air. So if we see Kreutzberg go back to the Katars here, I would really expect to see Nash come out with the hammer as well.
Yeah, we'll see what happens here. Fearless is still on the back foot, just missing a couple of item tosses coming out from Kreutzberg. And, yep, they both go for the angled toss and just barely miss one another.
We do get that kick coming out of Fearless, but it did not put away Kreutzberg.
And Fearless is doing a decent job with item tossing, but he's using a... Oh, lands! lands the signature. Yeah. After four or five wasted attempts with the signature move, one finally connects and he's able to get a knockout.
Yeah, the movement on that move is very good. And from what I've seen of it, if somebody tries to attack you, for the most part, it does get the priority. We do have a little bit of pinballing going on there.
Yeah, they're at the bottom in the shenanigans portion of the stage, as I like to call it. Oh! Great item toss to get the knockout from Kreutz.
Yeah, and so much, like you said, the shenanigan area. So many shenanigans do happen in that area just because it's got that bridge.
Yep, it's one of my favorite things about the stadium map here on Brawlhalla. Because the air game and the recovery game is really important. We can see, oh, and he lands a signature move from Lucian. That's great use of that to punish the missed time there on the item throw.
Yeah, we
pretty much the next hit or explosion, people are going to lose their life.
You see Kreutzberg throwing bomb after bomb. We did get a double mine hit earlier, but it does look like right now on the back leg, on the back foot, as you like to say, is Nash.
Yep, this situation where you've got one hit left to go is almost impossible to recover from. You know, you would have to have some very lucky circumstances. So, I mean, Kreutzberg has just been doing a great job. He's looking really solid.
Yeah, looks like he will go on to the finals. It's a matter of, you know, he wanted to face Misfit in the brackets. He might just get to do that if Misfit wins the next game. Though we still do need to see if Fearless can pull this out somehow.
Yeah, one of the things I've noticed about Fearless is that it seems like he doesn't really, he's unsure of what to do. There it goes, the knockout.
There it goes.
Oh, that's a brutal way to go.
Yeah, it does happen, though. So, yeah, it looks like Kreutzberg going to be moving on at this point. So, yeah, our next matchup is going to be with Misfit and Dyne. So, like I said earlier, Kreutzberg and Misfit, I mean, Kreutzberg wanted to play Misfit in this tournament, in the bracketing. He might just get to do that if Misfit wins here. So, what are you looking to come out of these two players coming up in this next game?
Well, Misfit, I know, like the back of my hand. The one that holds my Xbox controller. As far as to Dyne, I know that he's been working hard. I haven't been able to play him in the last couple weeks. We played a long time ago, and you know, I think like he maybe took one life off of me back then. But I know that he's been practicing. I know he's been putting a lot of time in the game. He looked really solid in the game where he played against Jacob, so it's going to be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah, definitely. So, yeah, Looks like Misfit does have a game up. I'm throwing out a social media post real quick, but we will jump over to that game pretty soon. So, hey, Raidhyn, I know we talked about it a little bit earlier, but go ahead and give another shout-out for your YouTube channel, since you do a lot of Brawlhalla videos. Let them know the Brawlhalla videos you're coming up with, as well as maybe some of the other content that you're doing.
All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and post a link to it here in the chat, but I do cover a lot of Brawlhalla. I try to record some of the 1v1 matches that I have with Misfit along with other people and try to talk through my thoughts and kind of how I'm winning games or how I'm losing games. One of the other things that I try to do from time to time is make guides on different parts of Brawlhalla that I think are important. So if you guys are trying to improve your Brawlhalla game, I do have a completely separate playlist on my YouTube channel that's just for the guides. Some of them are really basic that I made early on, and some of the more recent ones are a lot in depth that kind of go into what you have to incorporate into your game to be competitive. And then, of course, I also play some other games on my channel. I play indie games. I've played, and I'm currently also playing League of Legends. So if any of you guys are also League players, feel free to hit me up. If you want somebody who's a terrible 80 carrier support on your team, I do some of that. Most of the people, I'll be honest, who subscribe to my channel seem to be from the Brawlhalla community. And for that, I love all of you. You're great.
Alright, so we're hitting that transition and jumping on over to the main tournament. I'm going to throw up that blocker. It does look like we have our pin, so I'll go ahead and get that pin in, and we should be able to give him the go-ahead here in a minute.
Alright, just let me know, and I'll queue up the players.
Do I have that right? Yes, I do. Alright, so go ahead, give them the go-ahead. I am all ready to go, Misfit. Or Misfit, Raidhyn.
Misfit's playing. I'm commentating.
Yes, yes you are. But you will be playing next week. So, yeah, it'll just be me and Wings LTD on the other side of the tournament bracket. There we go. We're getting started.
All right. Let's go ahead. We should expect to see Misfit on Hattori. And Dyne looks like he's on Ada once again.
Alright, so once again, we're getting Titans. I mean, how do you think this is going to play into the Ada-Hattori matchup that we see quite often, actually?
Well, it's going to be interesting. It's something where the question is if people are going to be able to deal with Misfit's better movement and defense capabilities. Right now, we can just see both of these guys kind of chasing after each other, and Misfit with the item toss. His item toss strategy does not work quite so well on Titan's end just because of how, you know, small the platforms are.
But, yeah.
You know, already he's doing some edge guarding, and this is going to be interesting. Right now, Ada's a little bit lower on health. Misfit's able to get a good hit.
Yeah, I also think it's kind of hard to use the Valkyrie horns on this level just because there is so much open ground. It's kind of, you know, if both players are up top and you use it way out on the side, you can't really see where that platform is unless you automatically know where it is. So you see a lot more of those weapon items dropping down into the holes.
Yep, and this is something right now we can see where, you know, as players are moving closer to each other, they're both dodging at the same time. You know, they're both trying to play pretty safe. Misfit's getting a great item toss there with the sword.
Yeah, and barely missing that bomb.
Yep, which is good. Both people have spears now. And we'll see what happens. Misfit, you know, he likes to use these item tosses where he's able to pick up the weapon even if it misses. And able to get the first knockout using the down heavy attack with the spear.
Yeah, so right now, 3-2 with Misfit in the lead. Gets that nice weapon throw out, but almost lands on that mine. I mean, do you really think it's go time now here for Dyne?
Yeah, I mean, this is the point now where we can probably expect Misfit to play a little bit more aggressively because he has the advantage. And you know, this is where you have to figure out at this point, where did I get my damage in? You know, what were the opportunities? And if you can't repeat that.
Dyne almost getting hit by his own bomb that he threw up a little bit earlier, does get hit by Misfit's bomb, but we did see him go down under the
hole. He punishes the taunt. Oh, man.
Pour salt on your own wound. Pour salt on your own wound.
That's why those taunts are dangerous mid-match, man. That's why they're dangerous, because you are completely open. And I discovered that the hard way with the Running Man taunt, because that thing lasts forever. Misfit getting a great down light with the double heavy air attacks there with the sword.
Yeah, oh, but right here, oh, and if he would have brought out his front, if he would have
knockout.
Yeah, a 3-0 to start this this matchup. If Dyne would have brought out that front attack with the spear, he might have actually caught Misfit off guard and gotten that kill on him. But yeah, we're going to go into game two with Dyne not even having gotten a kill so far. Huh.
All right.
I mean, does that kind of, you know, foreshadow what the next game might be with him not having gotten a single kill on that map? Or is it just the map?
I mean, at this point, Dyne is demoralized. It's all up to the player and him as a person at this point to see if he can recover from this. It's not a situation you ever want to be in. And if he can come back from this, even if he only pulls one more match, that's a huge accomplishment. Because when you're down a match in a best of three and it's that concrete of a loss, you know, you're going into the next match thinking completely differently.
Hey, but the last mini tournament, we saw it with Picklesore. I mean, he went out. Granted, it was only he had gotten one kill on that first game, but he came back and just rallied off two more, you know, 2-0 games after that. So, heck, we could see that from Dyne here. It's not out of the question. We've definitely seen it in the past. So, yeah, we can go ahead and give them that go at this point and get this started. Game two.
All right. Let me give them the signal. Start now.
Or die. Start now or die. Welcome to Brawlhalla. You start your game now or you die. There we go. Right.
Don't lie to me.
There it is. All right. So we get Twilight Grove this time. And once again, unknown names, but we know exactly what character each player is going with. Misfit on Hattori, Dyne on Ada. So what are you looking for in this map? I know it's one of the more unique maps in the game.
This is probably one of my favorite maps, actually, because I feel like it's just the right size and has just enough space to it to where all strategies are viable. So we'll have to see if this works better in Misfit's favor. Oh, and he gets the quick knockout there.
Oh.
Using that sword combination, that down light into air heavy into up light. I mean, this is part of the reason why the sword is so powerful right now, because of how easy it is to follow up with it.
Yeah, I mean, the sword, to me, I mean, some of the hitboxes are way too big. Like, that down light from the ground move, that actually extends quite a bit behind the actual character model. And I don't think it really matches the actual animation, but it's a huge hitbox.
Yeah, it's really interesting, because I was talking to the developers about how they do the hitboxes. And what's interesting about it is, unlike some other games, they develop the art first and then put the hitbox over it. Whereas in other fighters, they'll develop the hitbox first and then create art to match it. And so sometimes that's why the hitboxes can be a little bit different. But it's something where I think, you know, as a player, you just have to get used to how the hitboxes for each move work. And
yeah.
Right now the sword definitely is superior in a lot of ways. When you're able to get that down light attack off, it just leads to such great combos.
Yeah, I mean, you can basically do anything coming out of that except for maybe a signature move. I mean,
yep.
Some of those are a little bit slower, so you might not be able to get them out of it.
And see, right here we can see Misfit doesn't have a weapon. And he punishes with getting the quick uppercut. And Misfit's been doing a great job this while being weaponless of just, like, distancing himself from Ada while she has the advantage with a weapon and not putting himself into a bad situation.
Yeah, all I know is uppercut OP. Uppercut OP.
It is. I mean, and they nerfed the force damage on uppercut in 1.5, and it's still good.
We get our first kill coming out of Dyne right there of this actual match. So we're in game two. It's 2-1. Dyne has a little bit of health taken off so far. Might actually suicide for the last death. And that's it, ladies and gentlemen. Misfit beats Dyne in two, moves on to face Kreutzberg. So it looks like that matchup that Kreutzberg wanted is going to happen. Granted, they both had to come from opposite sides of the bracket.
All right, man, this is going to be interesting. Coming up here into the finals, where we are going to have Misfit versus Kreutz. This is going to be pretty interesting because Misfit's been training quite a lot, Kreutz has been training quite a lot, and whoever comes out on top is going to be training with me quite a lot, so we'll see what happens.
Yeah, so much like when we went into the semifinals, guys, we are going to want you to post out on social media, get as many people as we can here to see this final between Kreutzberg and Misfit. We're actually going to be stepping up to a five-stock best of three this time around, but as you do all that, as you get that, we're going to go ahead and take a quick break and run that intro video again just for kind of continuity's sake so that, you know, if we want to clip out that that finals, we have that right at the beginning as kind of an intro, like you see on all of Raidhyn's videos on YouTube where he has the quick little 5-second intro. So, yeah, we'll be back here in a couple of minutes.
We'll see you guys for the finals.
Oh, yeah. Alright, so Compton is back, and with me, as the whole day has been, is Raidhyn. So, Raidhyn, I mean, here we are at the finals. I mean, it's Kreutzberg versus Misfit. Who do you think is going to win this? And your mic is muted. He's not there. But yeah, if you guys enjoy these tournaments and maybe have a suggestion of how we can improve them, go ahead and give us those suggestions on the Brawlhalla Reddit. So there's a Reddit for Brawlhalla. We do use it. We will throw a thread up for suggestions and maybe some stuff from you guys so that we can improve these for you, the viewers, and you, the players, so that we can get better tournaments rolled out and get everything going perfectly before, you know, the big mass flood of open beta happens. We don't know when that'll be, but hey, it's coming, and we want everything worked out. So, it does look like Raidhyn still muted right now in the mumble. So, he's not back yet. So, yeah. Scroyan did enter into this, but he was having some issues with his internet connection, so he actually did not participate. He did come to me before the tournament. He said, hey, I'm not gonna be playing today because my internet, the only place I can sit and play, I don't have a good internet connection. So I am gonna pass on this tournament. He will be back with us next week, however, to compete in our large tournament. That tournament, we're trying to get as many players as we possibly can. I have lined up one of my old streaming partners and co-hosts, Wings LTD, to get in here and do some, you know, extra streaming. So, yeah, while we're waiting for Raidhyn to unmute himself as well, I'd like to throw out some shout-outs. We do have HSA Films. That's my production company. This is brought to you by HSA Films. As well, we have Raidhyn Gaming and Commentary. Raidhyn, my co-host today. He is on YouTube. If you just find the user R-A-I-D-H-Y-N, you can go ahead and find his videos. He not only does Brawlhalla videos, but does quite a few other games as well. So, lastly, we do have videogameexperts.net. It's .net. Are you looking for a new game to play? Maybe you're looking at how to get past that next dungeon? Take it from an expert. Videogameexperts.net. So yeah, that basically is what's going on right now. So we're going to switch on back over to the 16-man bracket. And yeah, we're still waiting here on Raidhyn. I don't know where he is. He's outside smoking, starting without me if you need to. I'll be 4 minutes. That's fine. I haven't had a smoke yet. I'm dying for one, but I am your host. I'm the guy on camera. So I'm going to stay here till the end. It's going to be a best of three, five stock between Kreutzberg and Misfit. Two top players. You know, Scroyan, one of the other top players that's not playing today, was telling me that Kreutzberg might be one of the best players right now going into this tournament and next week. He's made a huge improvement on his game. And yeah, it does sound like Raidhyn is back with us.
Yeah, I just heard you talking about Kreutz, and you know, it's something that I find it really interesting that he's been this successful with what's essentially a brand new character.
Yeah, from what I've heard, he's been practicing a lot, kind of keeping things on the down low. Same with Scroyan, too. Scroyan might have a couple of tricks up his sleeve come next week. That's what he was telling me, that both him and Kreutzberg have had a lot of practice so far.
Now, is Kreutzberg from Brazil like Scroyan is? Is he part of the Brazilian community?
You know what? I actually have that. Let's go over to the player info. Kreutzberg is from. He is a BR as well. So, yeah. Both of them being Brazilian. So, hey. Maybe we're going to see a Brazilian group come out. Hey, we could even have like a Ryder Cup of Brawlhalla with the different areas. So South America, North America, Europe, just kind of have a little Ryder's Cup kind of team tournament going on. That'd be interesting.
Yeah, I think it's going to be really nice once we go to open beta and Blue Mammoth invests in servers around the world. Because I think at that point what'll happen is that each region will start having their own standout 1v1 players. And I'm really looking forward to that period of time.
Yeah, definitely. And it's definitely something that right now people continually ask for. They ask for more servers. Right now, with the game being in closed beta and the money not really coming in, I mean, us closed beta players, a lot of us buy the skins and stuff, add money to, you know, what they're doing. They do have another game that they make money off of as well, but until they actually open it up, have most of the stuff built and open it up where there's a good cash flow coming in, there's not a lot of reason to support extra servers besides just the one test server that they currently have. So, I mean, if you guys want more servers up, get more people in the game and get them buying stuff. And definitely you will probably see some servers start popping up at that point.
Yep. I mean, the way that I've always looked at these free-to-play games is, how many hours have I dropped into it? You know, I'm willing to pay about $1 an hour. And if you think about it, some of the AAA titles that have come out that cost $6 on your, you know, PlayStation and whatever, you know, some of those games only last 8 to 10 hours. You know, that's like a, what, $5 an hour value? So, I mean, if you've dropped 30 or 40 hours in the Brawlhalla, you know, I have no problem throwing the devs 10 to 20 bucks so that I can get a cool Hattori skin and be salty with people.
Yeah, I mean, for me, when I was playing games a lot on my Xbox, when I was still an EMT and I'd be watching the kids during the day, working nights, I had Gamefly because literally I would get a game, I would buy a $60 game that's brand new, finish it in a day or two, and there was no more playing of it. So I just basically was out, what, $30 because my traded value was only half the price of the game. So, I mean, yeah, that... A lot of games you're going to spend a lot of money on, you're going to finish them, you're not going to get a lot more replay value out of them. A lot of these free-to-play games, they just ask for a little bit of money on a skin. A lot of these free-to-play games, you know, you can get everything that changes the actual gameplay mechanics by just playing the game, whereas the skins and stuff are how they make their money. So definitely, if you have this game, go buy a skin, go buy one of the founders packs. It does though look like the game is up, so I'm gonna go ahead and for you, Raidhyn, once again that thatch transition on over to the main tournament screen. I'm gonna throw up that blocker. I'm gonna go ahead and put that pin in, and I will let you know when to tell them to go.
All right, from what I've seen in the competitive chat, the players are ready to go, so...
All right, so I am ready to go as well.
All right, giving them the go-ahead to start now. And we'll get into the finals. Now, they know this is five stocks, right? They know this is best of five, five stocks.
They should.
All right, this will be good to watch then. All right. Haven't had a grand finals like this since
you won the very first one?
Since I won the very first one.
Versus me?
I played some guy named Compton who thought he was all that, but it appeared that he just got there by accident.
Hey, it was by accident, but I will tell you, I did not think I was all that. You can go back and look at the footage. I was just saying, yeah, I'm just playing in this for fun, because, heck, I'm not going to win it.
All right, so here we go. We've got Misfit on Hattori, Kreutzberg on Lucien, and they're going to go ahead and get started.
All right, so game one underway, yeah. It does look like both players getting some weapons. We do get that first attack coming out of Lucien on Kreutzberg, or Kreutzberg on Lucien with those guns.
Yep, and Kreutzberg again is sticking to his game plan of just trying to use that gun tilt attack in the air to keep the spacing on, and Misfit's having a hard time getting back on the platform.
Nope.
And great spacing tools coming out from Kreutzberg here. And this is the same playstyle that we saw him use earlier with great success, so we'll see if Misfit's able to handle this. He's on the back foot right now, so...
Yeah, and it looks like I had the blocker box up still at the very beginning of the game. My apologies for that, ladies and gentlemen. It is down now, however. Barely misses that bomb throw coming out of Misfit right there.
Yeah, and this is something where, you know, you don't want to go unarmed versus Blades, and Kreutzberg gets the first knockout. Very convincing first life there from Kreutzberg. So.
Yeah, I'd say he only has probably 40, 50% gone on his health right now.
Yeah, and this is going to be something that's really interesting. If Misfit can land his item tosses, he'll be okay. But the problem is that as soon as he goes unarmed against the Blades, he's in a really bad position because the Blades pretty much beat out everything at close range, even the unarmed moves. And Kreutzberg's doing a great job of hanging on to weapons here.
Yeah.
And Misfit's just having a really hard time doing any kind of damage to him.
Yeah, and the greatest part about unarmed, that dive kick that has so good of priority, I mean, the Blades have better priority with two of their air moves. So, I mean, it really just kind of counteracts the unarmed play that you usually can do with a character.
Yeah, and Misfit is really struggling right now. If he had been able to pick up a sword before now, I think he would have been fine, but Kreutzberg is just doing such a good job of denying him any kind of weapons or items. That Misfit's having a really hard time dealing with it. Now, unarmed versus the guns is a little bit easier, but the style that Kreutzberg is playing, where he's just maintaining this kind of air spacing control, it's really difficult to get through. So we're going to see how Misfit adapts And there he goes. Gets the first knockout with a nice uppercut.
The uppercut. So he doesn't lose a lot of health on that life, which means he's only basically down one life as opposed to a good fraction. But a couple of hits coming out with the blades there from Kreutzberg. I would think right now probably Kreutzberg's best idea is to try and continue with the blades versus Misfit, as it's been so, it's worked so well for him before.
Yeah, it's been really effective so far. And once again, we see Misfit without an item. Now, one of the reasons why I think Lucian is really good on a competitive level is because he's got such good move speed, which is why he's able to keep up with Hattori so well. But Misfit has a sword now, so we'll see if this changes anything and if Misfit's able to close this gap that Kreutzberg's created.
Yeah, trying to punish there on the signature move, but I mean, it's one of the things I saw in the last time you and I played. That signature move with the blades has so much reach on that last action that you do where you go up and forward that Misfit just completely mistimed it and didn't actually get that hit.
Yeah, that signature move from Lucian is really difficult to punish, and Kreutzberg is able to pick up the guns again and just maintaining that spacing in the air. This is really interesting because this is and he gets the signature move for the knockout.
Up 4-2 right now. So yeah.
Let's see what Misfit's able to pull out now that he's got a sword. But you know, this is a pretty big gap. This is pretty difficult to deal with.
Oh!
This far behind, but that certainly helps a lot.
That was a suicide mine. And that's the thing. Kreutzberg threw that mine there and then went down into the shenanigan area, as you like to call it. That was, I think that might have been a mistake. I mean, I throw mines on that bridge a lot when people like to use the shenanigan area just so that they don't.
Yeah, and this is something now where I'm starting to feel like Misfit's strategy of using the weapon tosses hasn't been working out very well in his favor. There goes the shenanigan area once again. Just missing the item throws for both characters. And let's see how they're able to deal with this here. Misfit picks up a sword. And just great dodge movement coming out from both players.
Yeah, we do get the weapon throw coming out of Misfit, though, that connects. And there...
Stunlocked with the gun.
Yeah, that really, really hurt right there, as there's only one life left there for Misfit.
Yep, so we see Misfit pick up a spear, gets the item toss. He's in the air once again, which is where you want people when you have the blades. When people are, it's kind of similar to the power lance. When people are in the air, the blades shine because they have such great priority over just about everything. So staying grounded and kind of spaced out so that you're not just directly stacked up is really important when you're facing someone who uses guitars.
Oof. A lot of gadget throwing coming out here. The board completely clear now, except for that spear that Misfit picks up and gets the quick tilt attack to even it out to 2-1 almost. Well, almost even, anyways.
Yep. And we'll see if Misfit can't make a change here. And he's just having a really hard time controlling the weapon items. And Kreutzberg is just doing really good. As soon as he has a weapon, he hangs onto it, and he knows exactly what to do with it.
Ooh, a little bit more unarmed, and he does get off that good combo with the unarmed, but Lucian, Kreutzberg on Lucian, using his blades to get kind of that priority, those priority moves coming out, gets hit a couple times, but I mean, could Misfit actually, if he gets a kill here, you think there's a chance he could pick this up? Oh never mind.
Never mind. Kreutzberg takes the first match.
Wow, in dominant fashion almost.
Yeah.
So yeah. Game 2 incoming. There's the game pin. All right. So we are ready for game 2 whenever they want, but I'm going to go ahead and throw up another update on Twitter, cuz that's what I like doing.
All right.
Sounds good. Takes the first game with 2 lives remaining. Can Misfit make a comeback? At Brawlhalla Esports. Hitbox.tv/ComptonEMT. I have 70 characters left, but that's good for me.
Yeah, you know, whatever.
You don't always have to use the full, right? I mean, All right, so go ahead and give them the go-ahead for this next game, guys, and we'll see if Kreutzberg can end it in two or if we're going to go to a third game.
All right, I will go ahead and... Best of five, people. Best of five.
No, best of three with five stock.
Oh, never mind.
Come on!
All right.
You always hassle me about that last tournament where I left it on three stock for the finals.
Yep.
I mean, no best of five, Raidhyn. I'm going to pick on you for that.
All right, fine.
All right, so the game is starting. I'm going to go ahead and kill that blocker. And what do we got? We got the same characters? No, it looks like Misfit coming out with King Roland as opposed to Sir Roland.
Yep, this will be really interesting because it changes a lot of the dynamics of how Misfit plays when he plays on Roland. Mm-hmm. And so we'll see if he's able to use this to his advantage and kind of mix up what Kreutz has been playing against so far, which has kind of been the faster characters. We'll see if Misfit's able to use this to his advantage.
Yeah, one thing I do want to point out on this character choice here for Misfit as well is Lucian only has 3 force, right? But Roland has the max amount of weight or defense that we have in the game. So it's really hard to send Roland off the edge, off to the boundary. And it's really hard for Lucian to knock somebody out to the boundary. So we might see that come into play here, where he might get some good force moves, but they don't exactly send Misfit off to that boundary.
Yeah, and right now both players are, you know, trying to do damage to each other, and just everyone's being very defensive. You know, we've got a lot of moves where they're attacking once and then dodging immediately afterwards. Misfit connects a really good combo there, and wow, puts on a lot of damage to Kreutzberg.
And Kreutz, though, getting a couple of uppercuts right there, putting the health about the same at that point, but we do see the signature come out.
And great move coming out there with
gauntlet,
the down heavy driving.
Gauntlet Throne! Did you see the salt come out? I saw the salt come out.
The salt came out. The gauntlet throne. All right. So we'll see. What Misfit likes to do when he's on King Roland is use the signature move to punish these dodge approaches that a lot of characters are fond with. So we'll see if he's able to continue to do that, if Kreutz is going to play into it or not.
Yeah, and you saw right there, Kreutzberg actually got a nice down hit on Misfit there. But like I mentioned earlier, that force versus weight just kind of kept Misfit in play.
Yep, and we can see right now Misfit is doing a lot of neutral air attacks with the Lance, which is a favorited move from Skroyan, and pretty much something that he brought to the competitive level with his Lance play.
Yeah, definitely. And we once again saw that weight come into play. And that time it did not, but it could have.
Yep, and I mean, that was a situation where at some point you've taken so much damage where any hit will knock you out. So what we need to see here is, you know, King Roland needs a weapon to do really, really well. He does okay unarmed, but when he's got a weapon in hand, that's when he's really able to do some good damage.
Oh, he gets a nice nice forward air right there on Kreutzberg, almost sends him off. But that is one thing about Lucian that I do like, and it's something I asked the devs when they told me they were coming out with another Guns character. I asked them, so is this going to be a Guns character that finally has more than three defense? They're all, yeah, actually he has 5. I'm like, yes! So
nice.
So while, you know, he's going to have a hard time hitting Roland out, Roland as well is going to have a hard time hitting him out. I mean, what is the force factor on Roland?
I believe he has a force of, I want to say 5. It's either 5 or 4.
Yeah, so not as big of a gap, but still, it is going to be a little bit harder as we do see the down tilt. More salt!
Yep, there goes the knockout. So Misfit's looking pretty good so far, and I think part of it is because, you know, Kreutzberg just wasn't expecting a character change. You know, and the way that you play Roland is you have to play against him differently from everyone else.
Yeah, and it looks like Misfit got caught on that middle platform, or we might have seen Kreutzberg take a nice hit.
Yep. I will also say that Brawlhaven is probably one of Misfit's better maps. Even since the change to Brawlhaven during patch 1.3, there's just something about this map where Misfit's just very comfortable on it, and he tends to perform incredibly well.
Yeah, and we do see quite a few of those signature moves coming out. I know you said he likes that signature move, but I didn't expect to see it this much.
Yeah, it's Roland's signature move is really good for punishing people who like to dodge on approach. It's something where, because of the spacing, and you can see right there, he combines it with
twice
the backwards
in a row.
Dodge. So he dodges backwards and then uses the signature move, which gives him double the amount of spacing than normal. And he's using it here to great success, putting down a lot of damage.
Oh,
there we go.
There's another a kill.
Knockout.
And another Four salt. Whoa.
So is, much salt on this field right
is
now.
Is there something going on between these two players that we don't know? It seems like there's some type of very harsh rivalry with all of those taunts coming out.
Well, you know, it's like you said earlier, Koisberg was saying from the get-go that he wanted to face Misfit, that he wanted to win against Misfit. And for a lot of players in the competitive community, Misfit plays all the time, and people know that he is the guy to beat. You know, you have to be able to defeat Misfit if you want to be able to call yourself a good player. And so for a lot of people who have been working on their skills in this game, Misfit is the bar. You know, Misfit is that point where you want to be able to say that you can defeat him. And, you know, that's likely what we're seeing here. And, wow, there's the armor from Roland hitting him. We'll see if Misfit can take this and actually convert this advantage into some damage.
Yeah, and that right there is probably the biggest difference in, you know, this match compared to the last one. But we do see the fall there. I mean, did Misfit not have another dodge to get back up to that wall? I mean, I thought it took enough time.
Yeah, it looked like he might have been able to get another dodge there, but it might have just been a side effect of him having been airborne for so long, which is something that Misfit does quite a lot, is just, you know, he likes to triple jump. He likes to use his jumps to get high as opposed to recover. So occasionally he does make mistakes where he's not in the position to recover the way other people can.
Yeah, and with a bomb throw right there, Misfit does take out Kreutzberg. So it's 3-1 right now with probably 30-40% on Misfit right now.
Yeah, and this is, you know, I'm really liking the way that Misfit approached this game using Roland. I'm going to be interested in seeing if he decides to choose it again, because it feels like Kreutz has been having a harder time dealing with it. And, you know, again, Roland's ability to just take lots of damage minimizes the impact that Kreutzberg has while he's, you know, putting down small amounts of damage with the blades.
Oh, and there it is with the guns. The guns have so much force, even with them having nerfed it a little bit on that that tilt in the air, the recovery move.
Yeah.
I mean, you just did not see any of that armor versus force really coming into play on that move.
Yeah, and that's one of the best ways to knock out King Roland is when he's high in the air, because the distance for air height. The distance for vertical height is typically a lot smaller than it is for horizontal. So a lot of the amazing recovery moves you see Roland push out are when he's knocked to the left and right, not so much up or down.
Yeah, we see an early dodge coming out on that recovery before the recovery move actually happens. Actually helps Kreutzberg to get up to the side platform, but he's getting tossed around like a rag doll right now.
Yep, and this is the point where Kreutzberg now is about one hit away from death, and I mean, it would take a miracle at this point for him to be able to come back from this. So yeah. It looks like everybody is going to get what they want, and we're going to go to a game three, just how the final should.
Yeah, and I know you were saying that everybody wants to play Misfit because, you know, he's the guy to beat. He's the guy to beat. He's kind of like the Goro to your Shang Tsung.
I don't really know what that means, but Misfit takes round two.
Yeah, it's Mortal Kombat. So he's like the mini-boss before the actual boss. So, because you still are the boss. I mean, you've entered 2-1-2 at this point. So, yeah, Misfit does take number two. We're going to go to game three, guys. But as we get set up for that, as usual, I'm going to go hit Twitter again. So, yeah, I am at GregRTHenson. So I'm going to go ahead and throw that up in the chat so you guys can see it. Not only send out your tweets, go ahead and retweet mine. Go ahead and retweet Raidhyn's. Raidhyn is actually at Raidhyn, just as it's normally spelled. When we throw up these tweets for tournaments, go ahead and just retweet them. We want to get as many people as we possibly can viewing these. So here is what my tweet is going to be. Misfit comes back with a character change. to drop Kreutz in the second game. Game 3 incoming. Pound finals, because I still call it pound, not hashtag. Pound esports at Brawlhalla. Hitbox.tv/ComptonEMT. Does not look like that is all going to fit.
Oh, come on, man. Don't you know how to Twitter?
No, I really don't. So, char change to drop Kreutz in the second game. Actually, I could... Hang on. I can do second. Haha.
Tweet crafting. A new skill brought to you by the Brawlhalla community.
Yeah, I'm not very good at tweet crafting. Let's change comes to came. Misfit came back with a character change to drop Kreutz in second game. Game 3 incoming. Finals, esports, Brawlhalla, hitbox.tv.com/AMT. With zero characters remaining, ladies and gentlemen, that's how we're going to send it out. So,
that's what
yeah.
we call mad skills.
Mad skills. It's mad editing. Mad editing.
Mad skills.
Looking at the wrong camera. That's the camera I should be looking at. But yeah. we're going to go watch that last game, ladies and gentlemen. Let me go ahead and grab that pin one more time, because I can never seem to remember these things. Short-term memory loss, let's just call it that. So
at least we got a lot of feedback on spectator mode.
Yeah, yeah. I've already given them quite a bit of feedback. They're already working on some things. But yeah, we're ready to go for the last game of this tournament, of the actual bracket.
To start now. 428,238. This is all going down right now, ladies and gentlemen. The grand finals of this amazing tournament.
3, 2, 1, brawl. Okay,
right,
that wasn't so good.
We're gonna see if Misfit's gonna stick with King Roland or not, and if Kreutzberg is gonna stick to Lucien, and how they're gonna adapt their gameplay now that they've both got a 1-1. Looks like we're on Brawlhaven again.
Same matchup.
Misfit's sticking with what works, going with King Roland again, and we'll see if Kreutzberg is able to deal with Misfit's King Roland.
Yeah, and I mean, after that drastic change last time, I would have thought that Kreutzberg might have maybe changed up a character if he saw Roland was coming out, but you know, maybe he's just so comfortable with Lucien that he just can't get off that character.
Yeah, and you know, that's fine. I think what it is you have to play with what you're comfortable with. Like, just because everybody says, oh yeah, Hattori is fantastic, doesn't mean you should play Hattori if you do better on Scarlet or Gnatch or whoever.
Yeah.
Ultimately, you want to play with who you're comfortable with. And Misfit's been putting a lot of time into working on creating a playstyle for King Roland over the last week or so, and he's come quite a long way with the character.
Yeah. I tell you the truth, I don't know why he was using Hattori in those earlier rounds. Maybe he was just waiting for the finals to bring out his King Roland because he thought Kreutzberg wasn't going to get to the end.
Well, I think, you know, like we were just saying, Misfit has the most amount of time clocked on Hattori. Hattori's been Misfit's main since day one, essentially. Mm-hmm. And it's only been recently that he's playing King Roland. And what's really interesting about this is that if Misfit takes the tournament, then the question is, are Misfit and I any good at this game, or is King Roland just god tier?
You know, he might just be god tier.
It's interesting because in 1-4, everybody said that the Lance got a nerf, and a lot of people who played Orion or King Roland switched characters to somebody without a Lance, but, you know, Misfit's been using it pretty well. Even though both players right now are on fairly equal footing, we're going to see if King Roland's armor is going to give him the advantage here.
Yeah, talking about those changes, one of those big changes that I've seen come recently was to that directional light that you keep seeing Misfit use, where you flame up above you. That one went from large hitboxes to multiple small hitboxes. So it actually, you can miss if they're on the wrong side at the wrong time. So it does look like we're getting a lot of good damage here, but Kreutzberg does go down first to a signature move. More salt coming out. I mean,
yep. You know, at some point with competitive anything, it's all about getting into the player's head. You know, that's why, like, one of the really common things that you hear about Americans who play in the international fighting game tournaments is that the Americans play a better psychological game than people from everywhere else because Americans are dicks. We'll do things, whatever we want, to get in our opponents' heads.
Yeah, stupid Americans, right?
We're not gonna let you win. We're not gonna let you to pull this out. We're gonna taunt you. We're gonna do things just to put you on tilt because that is gonna give us an advantage.
Yeah, definitely. And it's one of those things that psychological games really, really important. I mean, it's something I talked about after the first tournament. I mean, you hadn't gotten to that as great of a level as you are now, and I was already going into that championship match in the first tournament just like, oh yeah, you're gonna win. That probably made me play even worse because I was just, you know, resigning to it. As we do see Kreutzberg drop Misfit for that first kill with maybe 40% left on his, with 40% on his health.
Yeah, so we'll see. I mean, right now, this is a really small advantage. So, it looks like Kreutzberg has already closed the gap as far as the health is concerned. So we can see, it seems like Kreutzberg is playing a lot more defensively than he, like, not defensively, but more cautiously than he was in the first match. I think, or in the second game, I think the Roland pick really took him by surprise. And right now he's just trying to, you know, play safe.
Yeah, for me, it looks like he's relying less on that dodge and more on the spacing that he gets out of those guns. That's really what we've seen him use here so far in this game, as opposed to, you know, the maybe the previous games that he has played in this tournament. I mean, that tilt light in the air is really just kind of his bread and butter right now.
Yeah, and it's a great tool. It's one of my favorite moves on the guns. It has great priority and reach. It beats a whole lot of stuff. It's really hard to get through it, even when you're trying to dodge.
I love that that down heavy from unarmed, that little like spin kick. It's like the swords move, but just quicker, comes out quicker, just everything's quicker about it. Yeah. But we see Kreutz go down to his own kind of mess up right there.
Yeah, so we'll see what happens. I mean, at this point, one hit's going to knock Roland out, so there's not too much of an advantage. And in these situations, for me, it's all about how do I put on damage safely. You know, right now what I've seen is that Misfit's kind of been neglecting to throw his items, so we'll see if he's able to fix that in the coming lives. And almost falls off the stage for his trouble.
Ooh, and he does get a nice dodge coming out of there to get away from Kreutzberg, but Kreutzberg not falling there misses his recovery attack. And if he would have gotten that would have spelled the end of that stock for Misfit and might have evened up the game here.
Yeah, so we'll see. I mean, one more hit and Misfit should go flying. So at this point, yep, there goes the item toss, trying to get some safe damage in. Ooh, good attack from Misfit there. And wow, now Kreutzberg is down in the red, gets hit by his signature move.
Yeah, and we have about a whole life difference at this point. And tons of just heavy attacks, just smash attacks coming out of Misfit right now. He wants to get that last hit to go up 4-2 right now on Kreutzberg.
He does, and it's something where, you know, again, this is one of those things where if you're unfamiliar with the matchup and you know, you've been playing Sword and Spear characters, it's really hard to deal with someone who's on the lance as Kreutzberg gets knocked out. 4-2.
Yeah, I really think Kreutzberg really needs to just stick with those guns. He was doing a good job of using the spacing, especially on that front air attack on the light button.
Yeah, and it's something right now where it just seems like Kreutzberg isn't sure how to deal with this power lance and this play that Misfit is putting in.
There's
the hit. So, like I said, one hit away, and he's finally able to land it.
Yeah, that air punch that comes out on the light, left or right, so powerful on the force that it gives, but really hard to pull off sometimes as it comes out really slow.
Yep, and we just saw Misfit there throwing the bomb into Kreutzberg at close range, and that's something that, you know, that's a really solid tactic when you're on King Roland, because it's going to hurt them more than it hurts you.
Yeah, and right now, without a lance, without a weapon, Misfit might, you know, Kreutzberg might be able to get a little bit of distance here, or catch up some distance, but we do see that sword coming out of Misfit now.
Yep, so we're going to see. Blades versus sword is really interesting. What wins? There we go with the down light attack from Misfit. The item toss, solid. Oh boy, oh, that could have gone in a completely different direction had Kreutzberg hit with that mine.
Yeah, that could have been a double KO right there, which would have put him down 2-1 at that point. But hey, I think that might have been a little bit better than 3-2 with red health on you. I mean, is there ever a point in this game where you just kill yourself to get rid of your red health and just kind of have an advantage at that point with better health? Or would you rather keep that stock?
No, I mean, it's all about the stock. The way that I think about it is that it's like you have one continuous health bar. And the stocks are just a number indicating where you are on that. So if you're on red, the idea at that point is to just switch up your playstyle and try to play more safely so you can get free damage.
Yeah, that's we just saw something that I keep seeing out of the new patch and the new network fixes: back dodges to bouncing weapons that have been thrown. Very, very bad idea.
Yeah, it's something where dodging through weapons is interesting because your instinct is to dodge away from something, but for a lot of weapons, you have to dodge towards the weapon in order for it to travel past you, so it's something that just comes with a lot of experience, and... Oh, there we go. Good item toss coming out from Misfit.
Yeah, and once again, that weight or armor, whatever you want to call it, that saved him once again at that point. As, I mean, light attack doesn't have the best force, but it does have enough force to knock a lot of characters out.
And actually, this is really troublesome because I just noticed the clock settings are really low, and I'm not sure if they set the clock far enough to allow for a match that went on this long, because it looks like it's going to end up going to sudden death. Now, are we going to rule this for sudden death, or are we going to
make... When the clock ends, I mean, it's going to be a Misfit win at this point. I mean, we didn't set any clock rules. I think we gotta, you know, I mean, they didn't set it for like 2 minutes. And this was at least the standard 8 minutes, so I think that is the game.
All right, so there it is. And Misfit's been declared the winner with a higher score at the end of the clock.
Yeah.
Really intense match. Really intense.
Yeah, I mean, that is a finals to kind of go down in the books as, I mean... I don't think we've ever had a finals into that way.
No, that was crazy. And I mean, that's the kind of thing that comes out when both characters are trying to be really careful. And, you know, I just felt that a lot of this loss for Kreutzberg, he played a really excellent game one. I think he played incredibly well throughout. I think that he just didn't know how to deal with King Roland and just needs a little bit more matchup experience practicing against him.
Yeah, definitely. But I mean, Kreutzberg coming out and just kind of... He hasn't played since that first Impromptu tournament where he got knocked out by Skroyan in the very in the quarterfinals. Very first round of that one, as we only had 8 players. But he came back with a vengeance this time around and just, you know, played hard, made it to the finals. You know, it was really that character change. I mean, he didn't know how to deal with that Sir Roland coming out of Misfit. But, yeah, I mean, anything else you got to say on that match?
No, I mean, this was really great. I think that it actually speaks a lot to being able to, you know, having different characters is a good thing to have in your pocket. It's a good thing to be able to play two different types of characters because, as we saw in a situation like this, you know, yeah. Matchups do play a pretty significant role. So, and I'm just seeing now in the competitive chat, Misfit's going, I never thought Roland would help you.
Yeah, I saw that too. And you know what? It brings something else up to mind, and I know it's been a big topic for a lot of people coming in and playing this game, that all of the characters essentially feel the same. There's no difference in them. I will tell you right now, the difference between Hattori and Roland in that match played a bigger factor than anything else in this entire tournament.
Yeah.
Would you huge. You'd agree with that, right? And really, the only thing different with them is the stats, and one has a lance and one has a spear. Both carry a sword.
Yeah, Yeah, and I think that's something that it's, you only start to see the nuance of that when you get to this level of competitive play. You know, when you have two players who are, you know, at the top of their class, who are, you know, in the top 10 players in the world right now, seeing as it's only like a handful of us, you know, like maybe 400 or 500 total. I don't have the exact count.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you get to this level, character changes like that, weapon changes like that, the difference in stats, the ability to stay into the match for, you know, an extra 2 or 3 hits per life, it all makes a really big difference. And, you know, I think both players played excellently. They played incredibly well, but I do love seeing these two characters come to a head here at the end.
Yeah, I mean, and tell you the truth, I mean, I couldn't have asked for a better example of the difference in characters. But yes, we do want to, you know, congratulate Misfit. He has won. He is the only other player besides you, Raidhyn, who has actually won a tournament. So Kreutzberg definitely getting to the finals there, scrying another top player. We're definitely seeing a lot of kind of an upper tier, you know, maybe an S tier of competitors start to emerge.
Yeah, that's something where, you know, I'm looking forward to see how the game grows and evolves, and you know, any new strategies and concepts that people bring to the game. I think it's great, as you know, for the community to grow and get bigger. And it's nice to be able to be part of this, you know, competitive community where people are really focused on improving their game and doing well.
Yeah. So I know we don't have any devs this time around because they're all at PAX South, but I know I was talking about, you know, the boss fight. I know we talked about this probably 2 weeks ago, but instead of a dev match, how about Misfit versus Raidhyn game? One game, 3 stocks, just to kind of end out the stream.
Well,
do you want to do it?
5 stocks. And you, yeah, totally.
You want to do 5 stocks? So let's see if Misfit is up with that, up for that.
All right. We'll see what character he decides to play.
Okay, so is there a game up already, or...?
Yes, there is. I just shared you the number. And I will let you know when we start.
Alright, so... let me go ahead and get the stream all ready for you guys. So, we're going to run with Thatch. So, yeah, we've had our finals. Here comes the boss match, guys. The boss. Misfit is going to play who we have coined as the boss in Brawlhalla.
Alright, so this is going to be pretty interesting. We are starting right now.
Oh no! Custom!
Oh, are we starting early?
No, I'm getting in. I'm getting in.
We're on the load screen.
I'm working as hard as I can to get into that game. Boom! Blocker off. We are ready to go. So, Misfit using King Roland, you're using Raidhyn. So I'm going to go ahead and mute me on Mumble, and I will just commentate this game myself. See you after.
And, yeah, go ahead and mute me as well, because...
Alright, so Raidhyn and Misfit, this is the boss battle after the finals. One game, winner takes all. We'll see if Raidhyn is still the boss here, using his Hattori in the Demon skin, Misfit on Sir Roland in the King Roland skin. Right now, both players about even on health. They are going for a 5-stock best of 1 right here for the boss battle. And right there, Misfit getting a nice light down from the ground combo on Raidhyn. You know, and right now, Misfit really hurting. He is in the red, but, I mean, Hattori doesn't have all of that much force right now to take him out. It's very similar to what we saw in the finals between Kreutzberg and Misfit, where Misfit basically took Roland on to win 2 games straight. Nice throw coming out of Raidhyn, and then the light neutral in the air to just kick Misfit off, him and his King Roland off the top of the screen. Such a powerful force on that last kick if you can get all 3 attacks. Nice throw coming out of Raidhyn there. Manages to dodge before hitting the boundary. Dodge a great cancel for when you're flying like that. But Raidhyn right now with a down tilt I find it really hard to pull those off. It's a very dangerous move, as you're basically just opening yourself up if you do not hit it. But lots of movement and throwing come out of Raidhyn here. And he's up 5-4 right now, dropping Misfit into dark orange health. Can he pull off a 2 life? He does dodge there at the end. Oh, gets a throw! Beautiful movement there coming out of Raidhyn. That is why we do say he is the boss. Waits for the end of that dodge and hits Misfit with it and gets the kill. So it's 5-3 right now. Raidhyn just taking it to Misfit. I mean, you know, Raidhyn right now, the top player in the game. Everybody pretty much plays Misfit. And Raidhyn once again, you know, coming back. Oh no, he misses his recovery there with the dodge and the uppercut. You know, we don't see a taunt coming out of Misfit. There seems to be a little bit more respect there from Misfit for Raidhyn than he did have for Kreutzberg. I mean, another throw coming out of Raidhyn. Nice combo, neutral combo, light coming out of Misfit. Gets punished for that signature move. And Raidhyn's all about the punishing. That might be why Misfit has such a hard time with him. Misfit very big on the dodging, Raidhyn very big on the punishment. And you can punish dodges, you definitely can. So right now, Raidhyn with a good lead, over a life lead on Misfit right now, as it's 4-3 on stock, but Raidhyn in yellow and Misfit in red. Deep, deep red. Oh, an uppercut coming out of Misfit. It does get some damage on Raidhyn, but there it is. 4-2, Raidhyn over Misfit right now. Raidhyn probably sitting at about 40% health. 40% damage. I'm not going to call it health anymore. It's not health. I mean, he had 60% health, whereas, you know, 40% damage makes more sense. Yeah, I think I'll do that. Nice throw to just kind of zone Misfit into a neutral light, but he does get taken out there with that that mine. And it's 3-2 right now. Misfit maybe at 40 to 50% health. Raidhyn, with that unarmed light, that light neutral, trying to catch Misfit off guard there in the air. Does not get it, but does get a quick dive kick coming out. Misfit with a great throw of that mine does get Raidhyn for some damage. Raidhyn getting hit by his own bomb. Does get the forward kick from the ground and the uppercut to send it to 3-1. Raidhyn right now over Misfit. Raidhyn probably at about 40% damage right now. And there's the dodge with the bomb. Almost jumps up into that mine. Uses the mine to launch the sword. Sometimes a great timing factor. Does get a double recovery there on Misfit. Now the throw. And Raidhyn just showing why we call him the boss right now, as he's up basically 2 whole lives. More than 2 lives now. And can anybody stop this madness? He does get that last kill at the end. Misfit did have one accident. So, yeah, I'm going to unmute that. And Raidhyn, you are still the boss, apparently. The boss battle.
Well, well, like I was saying at the very beginning of the stream, I've been playing Misfit quite a lot, and I know what he does. So I know specifically how to beat him.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, that's basically it. Anything to say in closing?
Well, I'm really looking forward to the tournament that we're going to be holding. It's still on the 31st, correct?
Yes, it is still on the 31st. We had thought about changing it because we're interfering with a big Smash tournament, and we wanted some bigger Smash players to come. We decided, you know what, it's still kind of early in the tournament kind of rollout. Let's wait till the next big tournament and then get some big Smash players in. If they don't end up joining the mini tournaments we have between this upcoming big tournament and the following big tournament. So,
yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. The next tournament's going to be a bit longer. It's going to be a lot more stressful playing in it. I'm going to be trying to do videos throughout the course of it, just like I did in the last few tournaments that I was playing in. So, But as for today, thanks everybody for coming out. It's been awesome. Thanks for everybody who's been watching. Thanks to everybody who participated. And I'm really looking forward to see how everybody steps up their game between now and next week.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. But yeah, I mean, that's about it. Any shout-outs you want to get to before I do my shout-outs and play that video one more time?
Just shout-outs to everybody who's asked to 1v1 me. I know I've been a little out of the loop recently and haven't been spending as much time on Brawlhalla, but you know, I do appreciate it. I am always down to train and 1v1 with people, so if any of you are looking to up your skills between now and the next tournament, feel free to hit me up. And shout out to all of you who are subscribers to my YouTube channel, because I love you guys and I really appreciate it. And of course, to you, Compton.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And thank you, Raidhyn, for jumping in. I know you didn't want to compete in this tournament. I know, you know, you're more of a player and more of a recorded commentary as opposed to a live commentary guy, but I really appreciate you jumping on. It really helps my voice out, especially since I think I'm coming down with something after the rest of my family already did. So
yeah, I'm in the same boat right now.
So yeah, the throat's hurting just a little bit. You might hear a little bit of rasp coming out of me, but yes, thank you for being here.
Those vocal cords.
Yes.
Oh, I gotta go take a break.
But yeah, as Raidhyn goes, everybody wave like Raidhyn Satori is. Thanks again, Raidhyn.
Yep, thank you, and I'll see you at the next tournament.
Oh yeah, definitely. All right, so as was said right there, yeah, we do have another tournament coming up on the 31st. We're trying to make this tournament as big as we possibly can. If you go on over to the Steam discussions for Brawlhalla, there is actually a thread there for you to sign up. The tournament's going to be called A Maceballs with a hashtag on the front, attack. So A Maceballs attack. That is going to be the thread you sign up on. We're going to be going live. It's going to take as long as it possibly takes. I'm bringing in an old streaming and co-host buddy of mine, Wings LTD, to do half of the bracket so that we can stream every single game that we possibly can. We're still going to have our FFA, our free-for-all seating rounds, so we probably won't stream those. There's going to be a lot of them. But yeah, we're going to try and stream every single bracket game of that tournament between Wings and myself. So yeah, if you have friends, definitely jump on over and grab them, get them in. I know I didn't do any key giveaways, but you know, I'll do one once I put up the recap video for this. I'll do a comment competition. I'll go ahead and put it in the info for the recap video. So yeah, guys, thanks for having us, but do want to give a couple shout outs. HSA Films, that's my production company. This is technically put on by HSA Films. We also run the CC Radio, which is a Creative Commons radio. It's all music that is licensed under a attribution, a BY, or an attribution share alike, BYSA. What that means to you is you can use those songs in videos. They're available for you to use, even commercially, without having to worry about copyright. You do, however, with the share alike clause, do have to share anything you do with it as a BYSA license. That's what share alike means. So yeah, other notables are Raidhyn. He was the co-host today. Go check him out on YouTube. He does gaming and commentary. Does a lot of Brawlhalla videos, as well as some for other games. Definitely subscribe to him. He's looking to get as many subscribers as he can at this point. So it's exactly how it is there on the screen. That is the user you are looking for on YouTube. Additionally, one more thing, videogameexperts.net. Are you looking how to beat that next dungeon? Maybe you're looking for a good game to play. How about you take an expert's opinion and jump on over to videogameexperts.net? All right, so I'm Compton EMT. Thank you for joining us. And going to wave bye just like Hattori's waving bye to you there. And going to show you that intro video one more time. So let's kill the CC radio. And yeah. Peace. If I get the transition.
Welcome to Brawlhalla. Bodvar. Good. Cassidy. Orion. Lord Brax. Nav. Queen Kai. Hattori. Scarlet. Yeah. That. 2, 1, brawl!